26 family-owned locations, open 7 days a week, and online at PaylessLiquors.com. Don't pay more, get more, pay less at Payless Liquors.
This is Ryan Newman for Indiana Donor Network and Driven to Save Lives. When I'm not racing around at 200 miles an hour, I like to take things a little slower. But even here at the lake, I'm still driven to save lives. So if you're like me and you enjoy fishing or hunting, say yes to being an organ donor when you get your license online or when you renew your driver's license. Learn more and sign up today to be an organ donor at DonateLifeIndiana.org.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
It's Kevin and Querry.
I throw, you catch. It's not that hard, okay? All right, get the f*** out of here.
I'm going to talk a lot about drills and fundamentals.
Watch it, watch it, watch it, watch it.
On 93.5.
Watch it.
And 107.5.
Boom, baby.
The Fan.
Hey, good morning to you. It is a Friday. A Friday that kind of feels like a... It felt like yesterday was a Friday to an extent because a lot of people felt like a Saturday to some extent because I think a lot of places people just stayed home, understandably. Jake Query here along with Kevin Bowen. Josh Molinex filling in as Mark Dykton exercising part of his 9 weeks vacation. Kevin, let's get to the meat of the matter right off the top. I think personally, kudos to... I don't know the technical name of the jurisdiction, the Department of Public Works, the City of Indianapolis, the men and women behind the salt trucks, whatever you want to say. I realize the side roads were probably pretty bad because everything's plowed over to that. But I went down Capitol, I went across 16th, and then down Meridian. And I thought the fact that what we went through yesterday, kudos for the fact that it was pretty passable.
Yeah, I mean, I was an extra 5 minutes, maybe. Maybe a little bit more than that.
Right.
And so nothing too bad at all for me. So I would echo what you just said there. I mean, folks, it's not clear. You know, look at how much rain we got Wednesday. And then all of a sudden, temperature drops big time. And there's some little layer that you're going to have to drive over. But I didn't feel myself, you know, sliding or anything like that. And for the most part, I thought it was pretty much like a normal commute into work. Especially once I got out on the main roads. Like you said, Jake, for me, it's like Central, Meridian, Washington. I know up north, there's certainly a little bit more snow. Did you see Purdue got stuck here last night?
That wouldn't surprise me.
Coming back from Minneapolis.
Okay.
So they didn't fly back after the game on Wednesday night. They stayed overnight, and then they weren't able to fly into, I guess, isn't there a Purdue airport or something pretty regional right there by campus? So they weren't able to do that, so they had to stay in Indy last night, and then they'll make the drive up 65 today, and they have Michigan tomorrow. Indiana, Purdue, and Butler all with home games tomorrow afternoon. Butler and Indiana both play at noon, and then Purdue at 2:30. But I saw this out on Twitter, Jake. John Perrine, if I'm saying that right, he's a state police man, a sergeant. He mentioned on Twitter, this is about 10 hours ago, 51 crashes, 57 slide-offs, and motorist assist, 151. So again, I think the further north you get, it is a little bit more dicey, but I thought the commute into work today wasn't too bad at all.
One of my favorite winter traditions happens every year. Has not happened this year, admittedly. I love, Kevin, this is going to sound weird, I love when you're driving and everybody's going 10 miles an hour. And I will say also, by the way, folks, we probably are still under the tents of, don't get us wrong here, when Kevin and I drove in this morning, there's no one else basically on the road.
No one.
So that is a huge advantage. So I'm not sitting here pretending like, hey, don't give yourself extra time. If you can stay home, you probably should, at least for the remainder of this morning. I think we're supposed to get a little bit more snow this morning.
Yeah, Meridian was still one lane for me.
Correct.
For
one lane is correct. Yeah. Yep. So if you get other cars out there, it's going to get slow down. But one of my favorite traditions is driving along and you see some poor guy or gal that the car has just barely slid off and now they're stuck. And then just the randoms pulling over and like three people like, all right, get behind it, let's go. And then pushing them out. And then the person gives it a wave and a honk.
Yeah.
And then woohoo.
Yeah. Civic duty, baby.
Yeah, high five a couple strangers. Like, all right, have fun. Like, it's just cool, man. I love it. That's one of the fun things about it. But didn't happen yesterday. We'll see if it does today. But good morning to you again. My name is Jake Query. That is the voice of Kevin Bowen. It is Kevin and Bowen here on 93.5, 107.5, The Fan. Lot to talk about because the reality is, Kevin, a week from today, we'll be talking about the Super Bowl a lot. And then also everybody's talking about the fact that, you know, we're right here in the 10-year anniversary of the Super Bowl being in Indianapolis, which is, you look outside and it's like, what a far cry. It was like 55 degrees out, right?
Gosh, can you imagine if this was it 10 years ago? Oh, my God. People would be bitching up a storm. Yeah, we haven't talked a whole lot about next Sunday's matchup. It's something I want to get into a little bit later. I think there's some interesting parallels you can look at with how Cincinnati, how Los Angeles have been built, and how that applies to the Colts here this offseason. So I think that's something we can definitely hit on. And then we're going to have Joe Wiz on 845, our betting expert, to give us some early Super Bowl props as well. You've kind of hinted at this a little bit, but I think you like Cincinnati.
I do. You know,
is that the heart or is that the head?
No, you know what? I think it's the head, because I just look at their offense. Joe Burrow, listen, Kevin, I've waited for reality to kick in for this guy, and it hadn't happened yet. And he's got weapons, man, and I just think that they are still just young enough to not know any different. And why stop now? You know, why stop now? I think there's pressure on the Rams. The way the Rams were built, the way they pushed all in, and I give the Rams tons of credit for it. But for the Rams, Kevin, I mean, don't get me wrong, they probably have a 2 to 3 year window here. But, I mean, it's now or never, because of the fact that they're not going to be able to add a lot of pieces to what they already have in place. So they got to get it done here, right?
Yeah, I think there is more pressure on them, and I don't even say that because, oh, they're playing in their own stadium or things like that. You know, expectations preseason-wise for Cincinnati versus L.A., I think are two different ends of the spectrum. For those that went to bed a little bit early last night, we did have another head coach opening filled. That is Doug Peterson going to Jacksonville, Jake. So the AFC South will have a Frank Reich-Doug Peterson connection. We'll see if they have a Carson Wentz connection there. But Doug Peterson, quarterback, and your guy, Trevor Lawrence.
If you were, so you think Carson Wentz could go to Jacksonville?
No. I'm saying I don't know if that connection will still be there in terms of those matchups. Like when the Colts face the Jags, I don't know if we're going to have that storyline.
I see what you're saying. I was going to say.
We will have the Reich Peterson storyline. Will we have the Wentz Peterson?
If you're Trevor Lawrence, are you happy with that hire?
Sure. You know, I know the Peterson-Wentz era had its ups and downs, but I think Trevor Lawrence is a little bit different than Carson Wentz. So, at the end of the day, just give me some sort of offensive mind, offensive background. I think having a veteran coach compared to what you had with Urban Meyer, a veteran NFL coach compared to what you had with Urban Meyer, will be welcomed as well. Yeah.
You know, speaking of quarterbacks, young quarterbacks, you look at right now, who would you say... I saw an interesting graph yesterday, and I wanted to ask you this, Kevin. Who would you say are the quarterbacks right now, let's say the top six? Who are the top six young gun rising quarterbacks? I don't mean Aaron Rodgers. I don't mean Russell Wilson. I'm talking about the clear next era. Mahomes, Josh Allen, Lamar Jackson, Justin Herbert. Who am I missing?
Oh, that's a pretty good start right there.
Pretty much it, right? We'll go with that. Do you want to put Trevor Lawrence in there?
No, I think it's too early to go there. Okay. I think it's too early to go with any of the rookies from this past year. Yeah, I think that's a really good start.
Okay, now, look at those that just left or within the last handful of years have left.
Yeah, some icons.
Drew Brees, Peyton Manning, Tom Brady, Philip Rivers, Eli Manning, Ben Roethlisberger. Who is each's equivalent? Burrow reminds me the most on that list. Which quarterback are you most reminded of with Joe Burrow? Again, that list: Drew Brees, Peyton Manning, Tom Brady, Philip Rivers, Eli Manning, Ben Roethlisberger. Which one most does Burrow remind you of?
Give those to me one more time.
Drew Brees, Peyton Manning, Tom Brady, Philip Rivers, Eli Manning, Ben Roethlisberger. I think he's the easiest one to say who his replica is.
Boy, it's not coming to me as easy.
See, I think it's Drew Brees, because I think of Joe Burrow as a pure pocket, but just a laser-accurate ball right there guy. Not, you know, you don't think of him as like this big bruising. He can take hits, get up, bounce right back up, and throw laser darts.
See, he's shown me a level of keeping plays alive in the playoffs, Jake, that I didn't initially see.
That may be fair.
So that's why I was thinking a little bit of Roethlisberger, actually, which I know he's not 6'5 and 245 or what. I mean, hell, Ben's probably like 280 at this point. But Burrow's really unique. Really unique.
He is.
And I don't know if like he's going to wow you in sort of like a, you know, a combine skills sort of competition there, but, and it's hard to quantify, Jake, but it just goes back to probably the point you made a few minutes ago. There's just a swagger about him and just like an aura and a confidence that, you know, some will call it cocky and some will say, I want to follow that person because they're a lot more confident than I am and they're going to help me out in that department.
You know, there are a lot of the young quarterbacks right now, when you look at this, look at it this way, that we haven't really seen before. I mean, if you look at Josh Allen, you know, Justin Herbert for that matter, even Mahomes, you know, who is their equivalent among that list?
I think the pure pocket passer, like outside of Mac Jones, I don't really know who is that in today's
right.
Like you have to have an element of escaping.
That is correct.
And none of these guys are, you know, Lamar Jackson is a different animal, but keeping plays alive.
Quarterback draws. I mean, you never would have seen quarterback draws with that list that I just gave you,
right.
But like a Josh Allen, for that matter, even a Trevor Lawrence, Mahomes to an extent, they can run the ball and get you 5 yards on the third and five, fourth and five.
Josh Allen was Buffalo's best runner for like the final five games
crazy,
of the season.
Crazy, wasn't it?
Something else that I was thinking about is, and again, this is more quarterback related, Jake, but when you look at Andy Reid, Sean McVay, and let's go with Kyle Shanahan as well, Jake. So three of the four coaches, I think we would classify all three of those as some of kind of the like top level offensive minds in the NFL.
Right.
All three of them, I don't know if admitted is the right word, but got to a point in their 10 years where they were like, all right, I feel like I'm a really good offensive mind, but I can't make up for mediocre quarterback play. And I think it's a really interesting aspect to what quarterback means here in Indianapolis. If you look at Reed with Alex Smith, if you look at McVay with Jared Goff, if you look at Shanahan with Jimmy G, I mean, all of them had, I would say, solid quarterbacks.
Quarterback.
Yeah, I mean, they got to the playoffs with those guys. They've made different runs in the playoffs with those guys. But despite all three of them being considered some of the top offensive minds in the NFL, even they were like, hey, I can't do it all. And we're going to have to get some guy, and to your point, Jake, that list, get some guy that can do things that are not on a whiteboard, are not X and O's
but
drawn
up. What's curious
up.
About that, Kevin, is Frank Reich was in the same situation to an extent, and he got to pick to some extent.
But was Wentz now his version of Smith, Goff, Garoppolo of like...
No, because... And I think you're making an excellent point, but the difference is this. Andy Reid with Alex Smith decided that it was time to move on, theoretically. Kyle Shanahan with Jimmy Garoppolo appears to have decided it was time to move on. You know, McVay with Jared Goff decided it was time to move on. Frank Reich with Carson Wentz decided it was time to extend it and give it another go.
But is he doing that right now? Was 2021 the eye-opener? And I hear you out. You're saying Reich should have seen this before
correct.
Making a trade for him
that's
last
correct.
Year.
Yeah, yeah.
But was this season now the eye-opener?
I would think, if I'm Frank Reich, and I don't want to speak for Frank Reich, but I'm going to for the sake of Sports Talk Radio. If I'm Frank Reich, I am wanting to go one more go-around with Carson Wentz, if for the very reason to show that I was not out of my mind in convincing my higher-ups to bring him in and to prove that I made...
Dangerous road to go down.
Of course it is, but human nature says that that's what you want to do,
and
right?
This is the debate we got into yesterday about Chris Ballard of when you're in these positions, Jake, of authority, and like you said, Jake, this is human nature. We all want to be right.
Right.
Can you admit you're wrong? Because how many chances are you going to get to correct your wrong?
Well, and I keep going back to this, and I know that I have hit on this probably too much, but I am fascinated by this love triangle of Ursay Ballard Reich. Is Carson Wentz the... Listen. Jim Ursay is the dad, and there's a marriage between Frank Reich and Chris Ballard. And then you have the stepkid that comes in and is like, keeps acting up and is creating a division amongst the married parents to where the patriarch is like, look, kid, you're going to have to figure this out.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, is Carson Wentz, and Stephen Holder talked about it when we had him on this week, where he's like, look, Frank Reich and Chris Ballard work very well together and have great admiration and respect for one another. I don't dispute that. But as this goes on, if the Carson Wentz situation is such that Jim Irsay's adamant for moving on from him, he is going to pin blame on one of the, on somebody on how the on the fact the guy's here. And does Chris Ballard shuffle some of that blame over to Frank Reich? And does Frank Reich say, yeah, but you're the one that had to bring him in and make the trade. I mean, don't blame me. And then does it create a division? Or just an iciness?
Yeah, certainly. And an iciness at a very important decision for any NFL franchise. That's something we can hit on as well. Domantas Sabonis, Jake, not named an all-star. The Pacers do not have an all-star for the first time since 2014-15 season. That was when Paul George broke his leg. Numbers-wise, individually, Sabonis, very all-star-like, but I think when you are 13th in the Eastern Conference, you don't deserve one.
That's totally agree. Draymond Green said it best. I mean, I think it was Draymond Green that said, like, look, he's a great player, but look at their record. I mean, I'm paraphrasing, but that's basically what he said.
I find the Draymond Green comments pretty funny, just how, like, candid he is as a current player.
No question.
I know a lot of people are, like, probably pissed off about him, but I'm like, I appreciate some candor.
No, I think people like the candor, right, to your point.
I think he said last night the Pacers stink.
Yeah. Well, is he wrong?
No, but it's just funny to hear, again, a present-day athlete say
But the
that.
Question always becomes this, and that is, you can look at any All-Star game, Pro Bowls, whatever it might be, you can complain if you so choose about who didn't get in, but then when you look at it, okay, they would go in replace of who?
So, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure the All-Star reserves are picked by the coaches. So I know some people will be like, well, that doesn't shock you. You know, fans, they aren't going to vote for the Pacers in this market. Do they vote for like a specific number of forwards?
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that, actually. That's a good question. Because, I mean, especially in today's game, right?
Like, right, I mean, it's so interchangeable. Do you have the reserves? I don't have
them. I do. The East reserves. Darius Garland of Cleveland. Fred VanVleet of Toronto. Jimmy Butler of Miami. James Harden of Brooklyn. Zach LaVine of Chicago. Chris Middleton of Milwaukee. And Jason Tatum of Boston. Those are the reserves. Maybe Fred VanVleet to me is pretty inconsistent. I mean, he's a different player.
I thought I saw yesterday, Jake.
It's a pretty guard-heavy lineup.
I had no idea this until I saw it. Fred VanVleet, an undrafted guy,
right,
going to the All-Star
State.
Game. Did you see the last undrafted player to go to the All-Star game?
Ooh.
There is a tie here.
Brad Miller.
Interesting name. No, but right era.
Okay. Is it a player that played either professionally or collegiately in the state of Indiana?
No, but I would say direct ties to Pacers fans.
Give me the college.
Oh, gosh.
Ben Wallace.
Boom.
Is that it?
Ben Wallace. Great job. That's great. You got to tell your fellow students you just got that. That's big. When they interview you, you got to make sure that you have the interview.
Hang on,
you
I got to. What's yeah? I was interviewed. Yes.
Okay. All 16 of them.
No, I just did one. Actually, I granted one.
No. Oh, okay. Only had time for one.
The professor allowed for one fellow student to interview me for our paper on that we had to submit last week.
So yes, Sabonis All-Star previous 2 years, Oladipo previous two of that.
Wasn't he?
Paul George the two before that, and then Paul had broken his leg. So 2014-15.
Ben Wallace was either like one of those like Fork Union.
Yeah, that sounds
or
right.
Or like Virginia. I always get this confused because
is there
Anthony,
a military in the word?
Or Charles Oakley, where did he go? Virginia Gosh. Union? Something
yeah,
like
he
that.
He went to Virginia Union.
Which Charles Oakley did?
No, Ben Wallace.
Okay, Ben Wallace, Virginia Union. Where did Charles Oakley go? There's a fork. Somebody went to a fork. I'm telling you. I don't think I'm crazy here.
Man, Ben Wallace had a couple stops. Had a long time
Ben
in the
Wallace
NBA
is a good player. When he was good, he was really good.
I don't realize
Charles Oakley also went to Virginia Union.
Okay. Come on. I mean, see, it's all up in here, Kevin. It's just a matter of bringing it out. If I could recite music theory with this same recall of immediacy, I would be getting a 4.0. Now, when I look at my grades right now, I'm looking at the grades. For those that are unfamiliar, I'm going back and taking classes to finish my degree from Indiana. And when I go back on the dashboard here and I look at my grades, and you can do that, one of them, it says 91.9% F. Ooh. Now, what does that mean? That's a hard grading scale, isn't it?
Have you acted up in class? Like, have they just said, screw the percentage, this guy's getting an F?
I don't know what that means.
Has your Zoom video been on? Or have you stayed awake?
I don't know. I'm very confused by it, to be honest with you. But that's what it says.
Well, Doug Peterson take Jim Schwartz, or I guess hire Jim Schwartz. That's something to keep an eye on as well. Colts defensive coordinator search continues there. Lance Stevenson will be a Pacer for the rest of the season. We'll touch on that as well. Kevin Aquari, Josh Molinex filling in for Mark on a Friday.
Sports with Dan Dockage.
Jaden Ivey is the best player that I've seen. I don't see a whole lot of guys that can get wherever they want to get to with the basketball. I don't see a whole lot of guys that combine that with shooting, incredible athletic ability, and then the ability to finish. I don't have any idea whether his mentality could even begin to get to where Michael Jordan or Kobe Bryant or those kind of guys are, but I see some of that in him.
Dan Dockage, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Fed up with companies selling your data? DuckDuckGo is on it. They help millions of people like you take back their privacy online. DuckDuckGo, privacy simplified.
Hey, Indy, want big winners in college hoops and the NBA? Catch me, Joe Wiz, host of The Fine Line, Saturday mornings at 8 a.m. right here on The Fan.
Looking for that perfect gift for someone special? Skip the flowers and chocolates and bring home a new mortgage this Valentine's Day. TheHomeLoanExpert.com.
NMLS number 1326241.
Gorgeous gaming, stunning streams, unbelievable bandwidth. It's another Lifestyles of Gagillionaires. Meet the AT&T Fiber customers winning at life with hyper gig speeds. Meet Gagillionaire Terry. While his love of streaming horror movies has him constantly on the edge of his seat, his internet bill won't give him a scare.
Oh, don't go in there. I'm telling you.
Because since Terry upgraded to AT&T Fiber with hyper gig speeds, he doesn't worry about data caps or equipment fees.
Come on, man. The door's open for a reason.
And best yet, he also doesn't stress about a price increase at 12 months. Because with the amazing Gagillionaire lifestyle comes an exquisite sense of tranquility. Most of the time. Live like a Gagillionaire. Get straightforward pricing with AT&T Fiber. Internet that upgrades everything. No data caps, no equipment fees, and no price increase at 12 months.
Limited availability in select areas. Visit att.com/hypergig for details.
Love. It makes us do crazy things, like being the first one to say, I love you. Or adopting a cat together when you're more of a dog person. Celebrate the madness of love with a perfect Valentine's gift from Helzberg Diamonds. Right now, half-carat diamond heart pendants in your choice of white, yellow, or rose gold are just $399.99, a savings of $400. Show her you're smitten with the gift of gorgeous jewelry at our best prices of the season. Hurry, Valentine's Day is Monday, February 14th. Shop at Helzberg.com or visit a store near you.
Trading in or selling your car, truck, or SUV, WeBuyAnyCar.com takes the hassle out of selling in just three easy steps. One, get your free online valuation. Two, drive to your local car buying center. And three, walk out with your check in as little as 30 minutes. So don't wait. Get your free online valuation now at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Find out how much your car's worth at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Here's what's happening with The Fan.
JMV gives away Night Ranger tickets all week, 3 to 6 p.m. Listen to call in for your chance to see the band perform next week at the Paramount in Anderson. Think you have the best sports trivia knowledge? Listen to Kevin and Query from 7 to 10 a.m. and call into the pop quiz for your chance at a Jiffy Lube prize pack. And follow The Fan on social media. The Fan is on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Like and follow The Fan for updates, giveaways, and all things sports.
For more info, click on 1075thefan.com.
Wow, I've got a whole 5 minutes before my next call. What should I do? Grab a snack? Nah. Text with mom? That's more than a 5 minute proposition. I have been looking at getting a new bank account. Is that even possible?
Can't believe you have extra time? You won't believe what you can do with it. Open a Regions checking account online in as little as 5 minutes. Then enjoy award-winning service and banking tools and tech that help you live in the moment. Learn more at regions.com/live in the moment. Regions Bank, member FDIC.
Does have it all. All of our pre-owned vehicles are Hubler Q certified, which include a 128-point vehicle inspection, a free Carfax vehicle history report, and two warranties. A 2-year, 100,000-mile powertrain warranty, and a 30-day, 1,000-mile comprehensive warranty. Visit any of our 13 locations today, or click drivehubler.com.
Hubler has it all. With PatriotSoftware.com, accounting and payroll, keep your time and money.
Mike Capel here, serial entrepreneur. I started my first business in the basement of a factory over 30 years ago. We had no heat and no air conditioning. Instead of customers, our office visitors were rats, birds, flies, and snakes. Our office flooded often, and we used blankets as our office walls. We were broke and needed help. That's why I created Patriot Software, to help small business owners with simple payroll for 1 to 100 employees. And if you need help, we will help you for free. Go to PatriotSoftware.com. Use promo code RADIO and get 2 months of payroll processing free. That's PatriotSoftware.com.
With PatriotSoftware.com, accounting and payroll, keep your time and money.
Are you between the ages of 45 and 63? If so, this is vital information for you. When it comes to retirement, timing is everything. Call Alan today at 317-814-6164 for a free, no-obligation Medicare assessment. Did you know a 65-year-old couple retiring in 2021 and planning to live until age 90 should expect to incur over $500,000 in Medicare premiums? Your health is your greatest asset, and the time to plan for it is today. Due to legislative changes, in order to collect your Social Security benefit, you must enroll for Medicare when eligible. Failing to do so means you will forfeit all current, future, and past benefits. Unfortunately, Medicare is not free, and many people are finding the costs are much larger than they planned for. Plan ahead for one of the largest expenses in retirement. Medicare premiums are expected to inflate over 6% through 2028. Call Alan Price from Thurston Springer today for a no-obligation Medicare assessment. Call today to see how they can help you get on the right path today at 317-814-6164.
The SportsCenter update on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan is presented by Big O Tires, the team you trust.
The lead story, by the way, and we just learned this, Josh Mullinex apparently yesterday also stayed at the downtown hotel, and you went into the saltwater pool yesterday, Josh, is that right?
I forewent my invitation little Josh Allen foregoing the Pro Bowl. Decided against it.
Scared by the sharks.
The Tony Katz cannonball contest I heard about that was going
on. The algae was growing out of the shallow end.
That's right.
Intimidating.
NBA All-Stars, we mentioned that Domas Sabonis was not selected. Here are the reserves for the NBA All-Star game in this Big O Tire Sports Center update. West reserves, Chris Paul of Phoenix, Devin Booker, then Utah's Rudy Gobert and Donovan Mitchell, Luka Doncic of the Dallas Mavericks, Draymond Green of Golden State, Carl Anthony Towns of Minnesota. Then, as we had mentioned, in the East, it is Darius Garland along with Fred VanVleet of Toronto, Jimmy Butler of Miami, James Harden of Brooklyn, Zach LaVine of the Bulls, Chris Middleton of the Bucks, Jason Tatum of the Celtics. Those are the reserves for the All-Star game. Noted snub, Bismack Biyombo.
Not enough fan vote from jQuery is...
I tried.
You'll be in the building tonight?
I will be in the building tonight.
Pacers-Bulls, that is a 7 o'clock tip. Our coverage begins at 6:30 Chicago. I assume they're at the Conrad right now. They probably got there pretty late, though. Overtime in Toronto last night, they had four starters play over 39 minutes. Zach LaVine, after the game, said he's not sure if he's going to play tonight. He played 42 minutes, battling a back injury. Bulls have had a great season, Jake.
The Bulls have absolutely exceeded expectation. No doubt about that. By the way,
Lance?
Lance Stein, you mean?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Lance Stephenson is in the fold for the rest of the year, right?
In the fold. You know, I think at times, Jake, I probably just write off Lance as like a circus act, and, you know, there is part of that. He has also been very helpful to a team needing point guard help right now.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing, is he plays a position where they have need, no doubt about that. Number two, he is very good in the pick and roll, and I think not just Domas Sabonis, who we see that he naturally understands how to move with, but You know, some of the emergence of Isaiah Jackson as a rookie and the confidence that he's getting in terms of his low post entry points passing coming from Lance Stephenson as well. So he does facilitate things for people.
I mean, think about Lance, too, 31 years old. When he came here on that first 10-day, you know, over a month ago, I mean, that could be it for him in terms of a final shot at the NBA. So signed through the rest of the season and then a free agent after that. I believe league minimum there for Lance Stephenson.
College basketball, you had mentioned it, Kevin, in terms of the schedule for the weekend. Illinois and Indiana, that's going to be tomorrow at noon. Right after that at 2:30, not on the same court, granted. It's Purdue and Michigan. And you mentioned that for Purdue, circuitous route to get back from their game against Minnesota, right?
Yeah, had to spend the night in Minneapolis Wednesday night and then spend the night last night in Indy. Could not drive up 65 to get back to West Lafayette. They have now three games in 5 days. They'll have Illinois Tuesday and then Michigan again on Thursday. Remember, Michigan had a COVID pause, so Purdue is going to have three games in about 5 days. I'm really looking forward to that game tomorrow in Bloomington, Jake, Indiana and Illinois. Trace Jackson Davis against Kofi Coburn. And we saw Kofi earlier this week, 37 against Wisconsin. You think back to that Purdue game. Remember, Trace Jackson Davis got into quick foul trouble in that game. To me, again, I'm putting Race Thompson on Kofi Coburn and then doubling the hell out of him just to keep Trace out of foul trouble and keep Trace fresh as well on the other end of the floor. I think that's a very, very pivotal matchup to watch tomorrow.
Who get Coburn and Jaden Ivey, Big Ten Player of the Year so far? Which one?
I give the slight edge to Ivy.
It is a slightest of edge, though, right?
Yeah, I know Coburn's missed a little bit of time. I think the end of game heroics for Ivy, a couple games ago certainly helps his cause as well. But yeah, that's going to be a great matchup on Tuesday in Mackey. So Illinois has got at Indiana tomorrow and then at Purdue on Tuesday.
Butler, St. John's, that will be a noon tip on Saturday. That's tomorrow. And then Robert Morris, going to be at IUPUI. Jaguars last night a loser, 61-55.
Oh, gosh. You got me nervous for a second there. I was like, wait, they beat someone that wasn't East-West?
You got excited, didn't you? How about, by the way, the Wyoming Cowboys last night? Big win over Boise State, Kevin.
There you go. Did they storm again?
They are seizing control of the Mountain West.
I mean, they are a tournament team, right?
They are right now listed as last four in.
Okay. So your bracket watches.
But I'm telling you, they were listed as last four in, but the Pokes are starting to move their way up through that because they're taking firm control of their league. They beat Boise State last night. It was pretty good. Also in college basketball last night, pretty good game between Arizona and UCLA. The 7th-ranked Wildcats winning that game by 10 over UCLA.
It's rare to see a couple of Pac-12 teams ranked in the top 12.
It is.
Or top 10.
It is. But, you know, UCLA will be a Final Four team. Watch.
I forgot how much they bring back from last year.
I know. And they've been, you know, they're 16-3 now. So they've, all teams go through over the course of the year peaks and valleys and things like that. It's the ones that are consistently playing at a high level that don't get into complete long skids that you have to look at the end of the year and say they've got a really good chance to be around. Arizona would certainly be in that category. But I'm going to say UCLA is a Final Four team.
And, you know, we're going to fall into this like Arizona's going to play a Kentucky or a Duke in the Elite Eight. And just based off the geographic regions, we're going to be like, wait, is Arizona that good?
Yeah,
but, you know,
I know.
We are going to get there at some point in March. All right, we come back here on Kevin and Query. Do want to get into the Super Bowl. We haven't really looked at Cincinnati, Los Angeles specifically too much and how they compare to the Colts. So I want to hit on that as well. And then get Jake's thoughts on one Pacers player that I don't know. I think my mood's kind of changed on this player over the course of the season. I think Jake, considering what he witnesses going to so many games, I think maybe the body language of this player is interesting to watch. So we'll hit on that as well. Kevin and Query on a Friday. Commute in, not too bad this morning. Still definitely a layer down there on the road, so stay safe, Indianapolis, and up north. Certainly a little bit more snow as well. You're listening right here on 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
The Pacers host their rivals from the north, the Chicago Bulls, this evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Are you feeling the pinch of higher prices?
Costs may be rising, but with Golden Oak Lending's 2.25% fixed rate, you can lower your mortgage payments.
James Hawkins here, president of Golden Oak. You can offset today's high prices by using the low interest equity in your home to pay off credit cards, make home improvements, or simply put cold hard cash back in your pocket.
It only takes a few minutes to see if you can save hundreds with this low 2.25% rate.
So what are you waiting for? Lock in our low rate while you still can. Start saving money and skip your first two mortgage payments.
Call your local loan officers at 317-706-GOLD today and pay nothing out of pocket.
That's right. If we can't close your loan, the appraisal is no charge.
NMLS 114937, 2.25% fixed, 3.336% APR, FHA 15-year mortgage with 20% equity and approved credit.
We're just a little bit over a week away from the big game. It'll be Cincinnati taking on Los Angeles a week from Sunday from the home of the Rams, SoFi Stadium. And if you go back to the AFC-NFC Championship games this Sunday, our friends over at PropSwap had a very, very busy championship weekend. Luke Pergandy, owner of PropSwap, is with us now. And just a reminder, PropSwap, the place to buy and sell sports props. And the beauty of PropSwap, along with the best odds in the country, you can buy or sell within a game. And Luke, you guys had people buying Cincinnati tickets all throughout that game. And you talk about a game that fluctuated a whole lot over the course of 60 minutes.
Yeah, obviously, you know, they were down 21-3. The Bengals were, and of course, we know they ended up winning that game. Anytime something like that happens, we can assure you that people were buying and selling at PropSwap and getting really good deals on a team that was down 21-3. We sold tickets at odds of 40-1 on the Bengals to win the Super Bowl and 20-1 just to win that game. Even Tony Romo, the announcer, was like, this game's over. So what happens in those situations is that people say, oh, let me just get a ham sandwich with this Bengals ticket, and then buyers can swoop in and get really good prices. That's exactly what happened.
You guys have a 300-1 Cincinnati ticket available, correct?
We do. It is the highest odds of any ticket that I've seen, and there's only one of them out there. We get a bunch of press about this 300-1 ticket. It is the best price on the Bengals. There's been some offshore people that have said, oh, I got the Bengals at 300-1, but legally this is the best bet that we've seen. $100, 300-1 cashes for $30,000. Now, pre-PropSwap, everyone would shout, oh, you just hedge on the Rams. Well, this $100 bet is worth $12,000 on PropSwap. To profit $12,000 on the Rams, you need $25,000 in your checking account to do that. Most $100 gamblers don't have $25,000 laying around.
That is what separates PropSwap. Again, PropSwap.com or download their app today.
The Home and Garden Show is coming this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday to the Indiana Convention Center. You'll find everything to build, remodel, landscape, and update your home. Meet the top home improvement experts who can give you guidance and ideas. Walk down aisles of informative displays featuring the latest home products and innovations at the Home and Garden Show. Explore the finest exhibits featuring kitchens, baths, sunrooms, and room additions, energy-efficient windows and doors this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at the Indiana Convention Center. See cabinets, countertops, and custom remodeling, painting, patios, and landscaping, the finest hot tubs and spas, plus much, much more at the Home and Garden Show. Get started on those repair and remodeling projects and see this year's newest products and ideas this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at the Indiana Convention Center. Get exclusive show pricing with local professionals. Shop, compare, and save big on everything home improvement at the Home and Garden Show this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at the Indiana Convention Center.
Hey, it's Big Joe reminding you that Big O Tires knows that tires and auto repair can be an unexpected expense. That's why they have the lowest price on every tire every day, and they offer no credit needed financing. No matter what your situation, they have financing tailored for you. Big O also gives you big savings all February long on sets of select Michelin brand tires. Earn a $70 reward card with installation purchase, plus an additional $120 in mail-in rebate savings on purchases of $500 or more on your Big O Tires credit card. Schedule your appointment today at BigOTires.com. Big O Tires, the team you trust.
In 49 states, it's just basketball. But this is Indiana, a state that features great collegiate basketball programs and the excitement of the pros with your Indiana Pacers. Now get the best of both worlds. The Pacers tip their hats to Notre Dame with a special limited-time offer. Get a ticket to the Pacers-Chicago Bulls game on Friday and receive a co-branded New Era hat. Tickets start at just $25 and available this week only at pacers.com/university. Pacers, Bulls, Friday, February 4th at 7.
It's John for Love Heating and Air. John and Chris Love with the best service this time of year, making sure you're warm and toasty in your home, and that no-cost second opinion at 317-353-2141. And if you mention my name, you'll get $125 off the most advanced air purification system that's out there. That's iWave. Right now, use my name, Love Heating and Air Conditioning, 317-353-2141, online, love-hvac.com.
97.1 Hank FM presents Acoustic Stars and Guitars. One night of music, four country superstars. Starring Gabby Barrett.
You're just trying to catch a good time.
Nico Moon.
Even
Morgan Evans.
Sometimes you gotta kiss somebody.
And Tennille Arts. Wednesday, February 9th at Old National Center. Don't miss 97.1 Hank FM's Acoustic Stars and Guitars. Tickets at the door and at hankfm.com.
Yo, VIP. Let's kick it.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
I know we're getting into the Super Bowl conversation. Let me say this from Josh Molinex, spinning the hits here. With a little, I think it's Robbie Van Rist is his name, but Vanilla Ice. Obviously, because the road's outside, you want to be careful this morning. 20 minutes before the hour of 8 o'clock, Jake Query along with Kevin Bowen. The ride in for both of us this morning, we did drive separately, but both shared the same experience, which was kudos and thank you to the people that were out plowing the main roads in Marion County last night because, yeah, they're not pristine, but you can see pavement. Pretty much one lane on most of them, but I noticed the east-west streets, and maybe this has something to do with the way that the plowing direction or the wind direction, I don't know. Some of the east-west streets, because I had to come across, I went down Capitol, then Capitol's closed at like 1800 North, so you got to cut over if you want to keep going south, and I went did so to Meridian. And I think it was maybe 21st that I went across, and it was, I mean, it just looked like a rainy day. It was completely clear. And then I got back on Meridian, and it was like one lane, and that lane was pretty visible. But look, we had a lot of snow and a lot of ice, so kudos to those who, and again, with traffic, it's still going to be slow, so don't think that you're going to get out and just get right where you're going. Just simply be careful. But at least we could see some light at the end of the tunnel. That song, by the way, was massive my senior year of high school when Ice Ice Baby came out.
Mike from Carmel goes, roads were pretty damn good this morning, considering everything. Hell of a job by the people working those were those roads. So I think up north, Jake, they did get a little bit more snow compared to what we had kind of here in the metro area. Did you go sledding yesterday?
I did not. You know, I'll be honest, I slept. So does that mean that I dreamed or dreamt that it was springtime? Is it which word do we go with there?
Dream or dreamt?
Is dreamt the word? Know. Josh, do you know?
Dreamt sounds so sleepy.
Josh is the private school educated kid here. Do you know that,
oh,
Josh?
Oh, no. I've heard both.
I kind of like dreamt.
Yeah.
Dreamt is a word. We're going with dreamt.
Is it a
We're
wordle?
We're going with dreamt.
No.
Oh, wait a minute.
Too many
Hold
letters
on.
For wordle, right?
Past tense, dreamt. To experience dreams during sleep.
According to Merriam-Webster, both are acceptable as the past tense.
Well, and did Merriam and Webster both agree to that?
The one furthering his education right now should be on top of that. So I thought you'd be on top of that, Jake.
The next paper I write, I will use dreamt and see if I get deducted for it.
If you lead with dreamt, automatic A. That 91 will be an A, not an F.
Hell yeah.
It is.
Speaking of 91, that was my senior year of high school. The Super Bowl in 1991. Who was the Super Bowl your senior year of high school?
Boy, that's a great question. So the Colts were 07. I graduated in 08. So after the Colts was, boy, I don't know. Patriots is probably a fair guess. I'll go with Steelers.
Cardinals?
I feel like
Steelers, Packers?
Yeah, Steelers, Packers, okay. Maybe. My I have no idea.
My senior year was Giants, Bills.
That was first of the Bills.
Boy, that's a good question. I know this. My senior year was the famous Whitney Houston National Anthem.
Oh.
And I don't know if you know this.
San Diego?
Eddie White was part of that.
I've never heard Eddie talk about that.
That was in Tampa. It was during the Gulf War, so it was a huge deal. And then we later found out it was all taped. It was lip-synced by Whitney.
No. Wait, is that right?
Now, 10 years ago tomorrow, Super Bowl in Indianapolis.
My senior year was Giants beating the undefeated Patriots.
Really? That's the David Tyree catch, right?
Mm-hmm. We had that on the pop quiz yesterday. Plaxico Burress, the game winner.
So, kids that are seniors in high school now will be racking their brain 10 to 30 years from now, trying to recall who was the Super Bowl in their senior year, and they will, of course, know that it was the Bengals and the Rams. These are two teams, Kevin, that were constructed kind of in different ways. In your opinion, you favor who?
For the game?
Yes.
Gosh, I want Cincinnati. You and I were talking about during the break. I love that Cincinnati Inquirer video that was making the rounds on Twitter yesterday, compiling all the fan reactions from them beating the Chiefs there in the AFC Championship game. I just worry about that Rams pass rush and their ability to dial it up. And as much as we talk...
And get after Joe Burrow and make life miserable. Yeah.
You know, as much as we just talk about Donald, it's Von Miller, it's Leonard Floyd. I mean, there's several guys up front. And then the Jalen Ramsey-Jamar Chase matchup, I think, is just star-studded. And if Ramsey can limit Chase in any way, which is much easier said than done, then I really worry about Cincinnati's ability to just kind of move it for the course of 60 minutes. Something that we've hit on a little bit, but the numbers to me were pretty shocking when I actually looked it up yesterday. We've mentioned before that the Bill Polian and Ryan Grigson approach to building an offensive line is much different than the Chris Ballard approach to building an offensive line. Grigson and Polian think you don't need to invest a whole lot, particularly in the interior of the O-line. Like, you have to sacrifice at some spots, and that's where they're willing to sacrifice. Ballard, clearly not willing to sacrifice. The Colts offensive lineman, Jake, I'm going to throw some numbers at you, okay? The Colts O-line, their cap numbers for this past season, the five starters, $7.9 million, $7.7 million, $7.5 million, $6.4 million, $6.2 million. So those numbers are probably foreign to a lot of people. But those are their cap numbers. Of the 10 starters in the Super Bowl, Jake, on the offensive line of the Bengals and the Rams, how many of them do you think make more than those five guys for the Colts?
Of the how many starters?
10. So you got 10 offensive lineman starters in the Super Bowl.
Okay.
How many make more than $6.2 million, which would be the last average, of the five Colts starters on the O-line? Oon.
Is that one?
One.
Okay.
You have one offensive lineman starter making more money than the fifth offensive lineman for the Indianapolis Colts. It just further drives home the point of, does line play matter? To a degree, yes. Does it need the financial commitment that the Colts have given it? No. The Colts were fourth last year in the NFL in offensive line spending, and they are currently scattered across the country and I'm sure some Caribbean nations right now enjoying their offseason. The Rams 22nd in offensive line spending. The Bengals 25th. You got four offensive linemen in this game, Jake, that make less than $1 million. The Colts have all five of their starters making at least $6 million.
And I mean, what are they? Granted, they got a great run game, Colts. But you know, somebody made a point earlier on Twitter. I thought it was a really good point to us. And that is the Colts' problem. I think it's an excellent point from Chad, and it kind of goes into what you're talking about, Kevin. Guys, I heard a lot of people complimenting the Colts because how they can control the tempo of the game. But the Colts got in trouble when they couldn't. If Jonathan Taylor couldn't rip one for 78 yards, the Colts could not score in under 2 minutes. And there's some truth to that. Like, it's great to have that line that can chip away, and Jonathan Taylor can break runs. He's right. And Taylor's an elite-level talent, but...
Yeah, explosive through the air is not something the Colts do well.
And what do the teams that are in the Super Bowl or that were knocking on the door of the Super Bowl do well? For the most part, with the exception of San Francisco probably, they're explosive through the air.
So we saw a lack of spending from Cincinnati and L.A. on their offensive line. Where they have spent is on their defensive line. So, again, all of this, the root of all of it, Jake, comes back to perimeter weapons and disrupting... of the past.
Let me ask you another question. I'm going to give you four names. I want you to in terms of like oomph impact as NFL players. Quentin Nelson, if you were to grade Quentin Nelson like oomph impact in a game of Quentin Nelson, what would it be? Yeah, oomph. Yeah.
How are we spelling that?
O-O-M-P-H. Not unlike dreamt.
I was going with a U, maybe.
Oomph. Oomph. Right? Like think about if you're watching an old Batman show.
I feel like
show.
I'm at a basement oomph party.
Oomph, 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 oomph.
So what? 1 to 10?
Yeah, Quentin Nelson's impact as a player at his position is what?
compared to the rest of his position or just compared to the game?
The rest of his position.
Oh, he's probably the most impactful guard in the NFL.
Okay.
10, I guess, if we're going on a 1 to 10 scale.
Let me give you four names, and I want you to give me the same score for these four from when they played. I'm going back in the way back here. You ready? Dylan Gandy.
Oh, gosh. Texas Tech for Dylan Gandy. Does that sound right?
I think that's right.
2.9.
Okay. Ryan Lilja.
5.8.
Jake Scott.
5.2.
Matt Ulrich.
Oh, man. But 0.4.
Okay. Those are the four guards on the Colts roster when they were Super Bowl champions.
Ulrich, that's with a U for sure.
So Matt Ulrich, Ryan Lilja, Jake Scott, Dylan Gandy. There are your guard combos. I mean, obviously, I think Lilja and Scott are the main two guys. Dylan Gandy got some good reps. He was a nice player, but again...
And that's 15 years ago. I mean, even if we're talking present day, Jake.
Correct. Like, that's
that's when it was more of, I think, a balanced approach to offensive, game planning and flow and things like that. George goes, you can rip off a 78-yard run, or you can manufacture a pass interference to get you further down the field. Colts had a lot of chunk plays via the pass interference this year. The underthrown deep ball and Michael Pittman drawing a flag or Zach Pascal drawing a flag worked out well. Yeah, it's... The spending, the resources, the investment. I don't want to act like offensive line means absolutely nothing, but you can get by, particularly I think in the interior of your offensive line, you can get by there. I think you get exposed a little bit more when you don't have the perimeter weapons and you don't have the pass rush to impact the game. Jake's going to be in the building tonight for the Pacers-Bulls. Jimmy wanted to talk Pacers-Bulls. Jimmy, what's up, brother?
Hey, good morning, guys.
Morning, Jimmy.
Good morning. Hey, first of all, this is the first time I've called in when Jake's been in studio. So,
well, Jimmy, you were my good luck charm, brother. I think because I met you, did I not, at a JMV remote up off of Benford, right? 71st and Benford?
That's accurate, yes. Gigi's Bar and Grill.
That's right. That was right before I got hired, so you're my good luck charm. So from now on, you are known to me as Good Luck Jimmy.
Let's go.
Well, I appreciate that, and I always enjoy when Kevin has me on, so maybe we could start something here. But I just wanted to ask you guys about the game tonight, Bulls-Pacers. Kevin, did I hear you right? You said Zach LaVine is not playing tonight?
It sounds iffy. Okay, gotcha. Nothing official on that. He played 42 minutes last night, has been dealing with some back issues, and the Bulls are in a stretch of not only the back-to-back tonight, obviously, but they've got four games in 5 days.
Okay, great. Well, I just wanted to say I really enjoy watching these young guys play for the Pacers. I'm not sure what direction we're really going here, but and I also wanted to say two things. One, is there any update on Isaiah Jackson's status? And secondly, and then I'll jump off here. Kevin, I'm done predicting golf tournaments. Last time I told you, I said Ricky Fowler win the whatever tournament, the American Express, and he missed the cut. So,
hey,
but thanks for having me on, guys.
Jimmy, we need a golf pick, though. I believe in redemption for you. AT&T Pro-Am, are you going with Patrick Cantlay right now?
Yes, I will.
Okay.
I will.
Lock it in, Jimmy.
You guys enjoy your weekend. Thank you.
So for Ricky Fowler, he's bad luck, Jimmy, but for me, he's good luck, Jimmy.
Exactly. Right? Exactly. Which, for the sake of the show, that's a good thing.
You were saying that there was a Pacer player you wanted to ask me about.
Yeah, let me sneak in a quick update on Jackson. I don't think we have anything official. The Pacers did not practice yesterday due to the weather, so I think the next update will come today on Jackson. Again, sprained ankle. Carlisle mentioned after the game, wasn't in a boot or anything like that. It looked like, pretty significant twist, but... doesn't sound like anything maybe too severe, but still, we'll wait official word today. Jake, I try to watch, most if not all of like the Pacers press conferences after a game, and obviously watch the games. A guy that I would not have classified as like a potential bad apple, but the more I watch him play and the more I like listen to his kind of rather cryptic comments after games, Caris LeVert. Really worries me, Jake. Like,
totally agree.
I'm seeing hero ball. I'm seeing moments in games where like he just does his own thing, and like Chris Duarte and Rick Carlisle and other guys on the court are kind of like, dude, what are you doing?
100% agree. Caris LeVert to me
strikes me as a nice guy. By the way,
I don't disagree. I have always said, though, that I look at Caris LeVert and I see a little bit of, truthfully, and this is where you have to be careful in the NBA, I thought this of Jimmy Butler in his original form, like when he was in Minnesota briefly and when he was in Chicago. I kind of felt this way about Butler, and that obviously has proved me wrong because he is an alpha dog with Miami and a bulldog that wins them games when it matters. But Ricky Davis is this kind of a player to me.
Ricky Davis.
You hear me use this term all the time. 2025 guys, destined to score 20 a game on a 25-win team the rest of their career. LeVert is a gifted offensive player as a scorer, but Kevin, if he's not scoring, and I know that he's had a few games of multiple assists, but if he's not scoring more often than not, he's not doing anything to help anybody else around him. And in addition to that, even when he is scoring, it's kind of coming at the cost of everything kind of shutting down. He's gotten into it with Sabonis a couple times on help defense, and you know, those things happen over the course of a year with teammates. I get that. But I watch a lot coming in and out of timeouts, body language, interaction with teammates. By no stretch am I saying that he is not liked by his teammates, but he does not seem to me to have the same kind of cohesion with his teammates as, say, a TJ McConnell, or truth be told, a Miles Turner, you know, that or Sabonis. Dwayne Washington seems to really get along with everybody. And Lance Stephenson gets along with the crowd for certain and gets away sometimes from what they want to do, but for the most part, I think also has gelled himself back in. I think your assessment of LeVert is very fair.
But kind of in a sneaky way, right?
Correct.
Like Miles Turner, hey, Athletic, come to Pacers practice. Well, why is the Athletic showing up to Pacers practice? Oh, because Miles wants him here because he has something to say.
Right.
His social media post. I don't see LeVert necessarily doing that. But again, these post-game press conferences, and then I really noticed
that. He just strikes me as a guy that marches to his own beat.
Yeah, the other night I was just kind of like, man, dude, I don't know if you're running the show. And by the rumors or reports, and we are 6 days away from the NBA trade deadline, he has been a popular name thrown out there.
Well, I think certainly they're shopping him because he has enough skill set, and he is still young enough that even though you look at it and you go, what went on? Why were the Nets willing to get rid of him? And then he comes to Indiana, and of course we know the health issue, and thank goodness that was, you know, that everything's okay for him there. But I think that he is still young enough, Kevin, that he is the one that teams think that they're going to be the one that turns him around and gets him going in the direction they want, because he is gifted. He does have a unique skill set. And I don't know that it's his fault. I just don't know that he's been in a situation yet where he's had to learn the maturity of being a straw mixing the drink.
And I don't know if he's like trying to impress those potential suitors. Like, is that some of his thinking? Like, hey, Brogdon's out, Sabonis is out, Turner's out, I'm going to dominate the ball here, and I'm going to go rogue and kind of do my own thing, and teams are going to be super impressed. Because he hit a couple shots late the other night, and then he struggled late as well. So he's a name that I've always, I don't know, had a little bit of just kind of affinity for him, and maybe it is because he's been through so much. But, man, I think there is some sneaky, sneaky diva with Caris LeVert. Again, Pacers and Bulls, our coverage will begin tonight at 6:30. I believe a 1.5-point underdog is what I saw for the Pacers. The Bulls situation, DeRozan played 45 minutes, LaVine played 42 last night in their overtime loss, so those will be some names to watch as we get closer to tip. All right, we come back here on Kevin and Query. Greg Rakestraw joins us every Friday. We'll do a high school hardwood rundown presented by CarX. Rake's going to join us, get us updated on weather impacting girls' sectionals, and talk little boys' high school hoops as well. You're listening right here on a Friday morning, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
When the Colts were looking for a quarterback,
Wentz checked the safest boxes while also offering hope that there was more there.
Look, the bigger question is this.
If you're talking about it,
right now your best option is Carson Wentz next year.
So you know what that tells me?
As far as the defensive coordinator position is concerned, Chris Richard, Jim Schwartz, Gus Bradley.
We're talking about it.
I'd do it in a second.
Your home for Indy sports, 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Armor Air is more than a heating and cooling company. They cover it all. Their service fee is only $29. ArmorAir.com. Day or night, they do what's right.
Looking for that perfect gift for someone special? Skip the flowers and chocolates and bring home a new mortgage this Valentine's Day. TheHomeLoanExpert.com.
NMLS number 1326241.
Hey, Indy, want big winners in college hoops and the NBA? Catch me, Joe Wiz, host of The Fine Line, Saturday mornings at 8 a.m. right here on The Fan.
Hey, I don't know about you, but I'm ready to get out of town. If you want to take that dream vacation or even a weekend getaway, then you got to go to the AAA Vacation Expo. That's right, the AAA Vacation Expo, Saturday, February 12th. At the JW Marriott, AAA Travel will be offering the best travel deals of the year. You don't even have to be a AAA member. You can meet all the top travel companies, Carnival, Disney, Royal Caribbean, and more. Best part, it's free. You don't even have to be a AAA member to attend. Whether you're looking to travel this year, next year, or beyond, save the date for the AAA Vacation Expo, Saturday, February 12th. At the JW Marriott downtown. Details at AAA.com/expo. You don't have to be stuck on the side of the road to get assistance from AAA. I'm a member of the AAA club. You can be a member of the AAA team. Are you or someone you know ready for a rewarding career helping people? The AAA Roadside Assistance Team is hiring now. No experience necessary. Head to AAA.com or apply today. AAA, heroes work here.
Switch to Spectrum Mobile and get unlimited data for only $29.99 per month each when you get two or more lines. You could save hundreds on your mobile bill. Plus, there are no added taxes, hidden fees, and no contracts. Try the Spectrum Mobile Savings Calculator today, and in three easy steps, you'll see how much you could save. Visit SpectrumMobile.com/save. Offer valid for new customers on two or more unlimited lines. Spectrum Internet required. Restrictions apply. Visit SpectrumMobile.com for details.
The problem with New Year's resolutions? They're hard to keep and not so much fun. But if you're looking to make better financial decisions in the new year, here's a radio show that can help you get there and enjoy the ride. Tune in this weekend for Everyday Wealth with Soledad O'Brien and Gene Chatsky, presented by Edelman Financial Engines. Each week, award-winning journalist Soledad O'Brien and personal finance expert Gene Chatsky will explore how our financial decisions shape our everyday lives. And why wealth is about more than just money. They'll be joined by Edelman Financial Engines wealth planners and other guests to help demystify challenges like generational planning, retirement income, and tax-efficient investing. New episodes of Everyday Wealth will air every weekend and will be available on major podcast platforms. For airtimes, visit everydaywealth.com.
Bet Rivers Sportsbook wants you to be in control of your football bets. That's why players love the same game parlays at Bet Rivers. Same game parlays let you mix and match player props and game bets and gives a payout boost to the winning combinations you want to root for. Combine two bets or combine many. You pick your confidence level and then watch the game unfold. Bet on same game parlays at BetRivers.com or download the Bet Rivers app. Must be 21 and located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
Does have it all. All of our pre-owned vehicles are Hubler Q certified, which include a 128-point vehicle inspection, a free Carfax vehicle history report, and two warranties. A 2-year 100,000-mile powertrain warranty and a 30-day 1,000-mile comprehensive warranty. Visit any of our 13 locations today or click drivehubler.com. Hubler has it
all. Of course, she needs a college education, but I don't want her buried in student loans for the rest of her life.
It starts here.
She needs a school with great resources, but some of these campuses are so big.
The School of Health and Human Sciences at IUPUI has the resources of a big university on a campus with a hometown feel. It's a more affordable option with access to career paths in Indy's world-class healthcare and sports entertainment hospitality organizations.
At those big schools, I'm worried she'll just be a number.
Hey, it starts here.
Hey, why not IUPUI?
That's what I was thinking.
A tourism, event, and sport management degree fits detail-oriented individuals who like to call the shots in a fast-paced environment. Hands-on internships plus dedicated professors give the education and professional contacts needed to land an ideal job after graduating.
The School of Health and Human Sciences at IUPUI. It starts here. Learn more at shhs.iupui.edu.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
Soccer Saturday featuring Indy 11. If this is your football, this is your show. Saturday at 9 on The Fan.
Kevin and Querry.
We'll have some classes at times.
Hey, we're calling the plays, all right?
Hey, we got to run the
it's down here. We'll run the ball.
Can we run it down there?
This place
we run it down
yeah,
there.
Jeff,
okay, so
we will. All right, we're going to call fast plays. Block.
On 93.5.
Boom, baby.
And 107.5, The Fan.
Okay, so my childhood friend Lori sends me a text that says, Jake, my sister Lisa's listening to you on her way back to Chicago from New Pal this morning. By the way, I'd go with dreamt. Now, if she was listening to our discussion on whether it's dreamed or dreamt, there's no way she's still tuned in, right?
Yeah, I think. I looked at the meter and the brake, and all of a sudden, just,
she bailed by the time she got to Lebanon.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be honest. 8:03 here on a Friday. Good morning to you, Jake Querry, along with Kevin Bowen. It is Kevin and Querry here on 93.5, 107.5, The Fan, on a snowy and cold Friday. It's going to be cold all day, but want to recap for those of you who are just getting up or maybe just getting out or curious. Again, our drives in, I went down Capitol from the Meridian-Kessler area, and I thought Capitol, I was the side street, or excuse me, the east-west streets and then Capitol, I was really impressed. I thought they did a really good job. I mean, it was a difficult circumstance yesterday and overnight to get the roads cleared. Kevin, it's disingenuous to say that you're going to see pavement and be going 45 miles an hour, but at least single lane-wise, I thought it was pretty manageable.
Yeah, and again, us at 6 a.m., we aren't encountering a whole lot of other traffic goers at that hour, so take that into consideration. But I was about an extra 5 minutes down Meridian, Central to Meridian to Washington. So not too bad at all, really, for me. I know up north a little bit more snow, but we've had some people tweet in from Carmel, and they said that they were pleased with how things were up there. So kudos to everybody. I know it's a huge process from pile trucks to salters to, you know, when you're driving that early in the morning. You know, I saw someone out in front of Shortridge High School, you know, plowing their sidewalks and, you know, shoveling their steps before school. So I know a lot of people out early this morning trying to clear some ways, and hopefully get Greg Rakestraw on here in a few minutes to give us an update on the high school sports scene for this weekend.
Yeah, I wonder what the calendar looks like, because have there been some games you think maybe that were postponed or moved around?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure girls' sectionals are this weekend. So, you know, Thursday is usually kind of a quiet night in the high school sports scene, if I'm not mistaken. I think wrestling, we're into regionals there as well. You know, typically when the girls have their sectionals, the boys have maybe a quieter weekend for gym space purposes. So we'll get Rick's thoughts on that here in a little bit. Something we haven't touched on really at all this week, Jake. What are your thoughts on, if I'm going to put a Colts fan hat on, the snake, Josh McDaniels, becoming the Raiders head coach?
Well, the first thought that I have is the fact that I'm old enough that I thought you were talking about Kenny Stabler. You know, it's surprising to me. It makes me wonder this. One of two things happened. Josh McDaniels, when he was offered the... Is it McDaniels or McDaniels? I always forget.
I think it's plural.
It is plural. Cameron McDaniel, I grew up with. Josh McDaniels, NFL coach. When McDaniels originally was offered and accepted the Colts job, and then at the 11th hour had the change of heart, the thought process was, or the explanation or understanding was, that Bill Belichick went back to him and said, Josh, I'm in the 11th hour here of my career. You are the guy. This is familiar to you. You know the drive into work. You know the building. You know everybody in the building. There is comfort and familiarity. And so he said, you know what? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to stay in New England because I'm going to inherit the keys to the empire. Now, one of two things happened, Kevin. Either A, Bill Belichick got a look at Mac Jones and went, you know what? I might have something here, and I might have the seeds of something that can grow back into another good run. Josh, I don't know if I'm in the 11th hour. I'm rolling it back now. I'm actually like in the, you know, it's actually 9 o'clock, not 11 o'clock. And Josh McDaniels at that point may have said, look, I'm not waiting another 5 years. You know, I thought maybe it'd be two, but now, you know, that's scenario one. Scenario two would be that Josh McDaniels, something happened where he looked at the Colts situation and just said, I don't like it. Maybe it was the quarterbacking position. I don't know what. Of course, at that point, Carson Wentz wasn't obviously in the mix. But
I mean, at that point, it was still Luck.
Yeah, you're right. Maybe he knew that Andrew Luck. Maybe Andrew Luck said, "Hey, I don't know how long I'm going to be. Who knows? Right? Is that possible?" That Andrew Luck tipped him off, and he said,
it was before the 2018 season. So Luck, at that point, hadn't played a whole lot of football recently.
Right, he was coming off injury, right?
You know, the McDaniels thing I'm kind of torn on, obviously, been a straight just in how he handles things. And we can get more into this here in a little bit. But now we do have Rake on the line. Greg Rakestraw, again, presented by CarX, high school hardwood rundown with Rake, courtesy of ISC Sports. He's with us right now on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Rake, good morning.
Good morning.
Rake, I want to begin here. Schedule update. Have we had any postponements, any issues? I know it's a big girls basketball sectional weekend, but was curious on that front.
There are several that have been moved to Saturday. Not all of them at this point. I think those that are hoping they can play, if there's any way possible, if they can play their games, say, tonight and tomorrow and stay on their normal schedule, they will try. But obviously we are all digging out of a significant storm in the last 24 hours. So my guess would be is that the majority of them would go to either, if you're a 7-team sectional, a Sunday, Monday, Tuesday finish, or potentially a Saturday, Tuesday finish. So
you can play on Sunday?
No, I misspoke. Okay, Saturday, gotcha, Tuesday. Gotcha, my bad.
No, all good.
Greg Rakestraw joins us. We're going to start doing this each and every Friday, the High School Hardwood Rundown, brought to you by CarX. You can find a location for CarX Tire and Auto near you at CarX.com. Greg, in terms of, let's begin with this from the girls' standpoint of girls basketball. Heading into the postseason, teams in the area or schools that you look at and you say, you know what, be aware of this team because they are really good and things are coming together for them. Who jumps out?
That's a good question. Just because once you get to this level, let's say in the girls basketball, and you're obviously into the tournament, the expectation is that, hey, this is a pretty good basketball team. And I'll give you the sectional that I have, again, hopefully tonight and tomorrow. We'll see if it holds up. But the sectional I've got, the four teams I have, are in the top 20 of the Sagarin ratings. Carmel is the one team that isn't ranked. Everybody else is in the top 10 or just outside of it in terms of Westfield, Fishers, Noblesville. And so like the group that I've got, all those teams are really good. And so a lot of that time as far as saying, hey, if this gets together, hey, look out, they're going to take off. A lot of that will be determined as to kind of who survives their sectional. And I'll give you an example. I don't think we were talking about Franklin a great deal last year. They made the semi-state. Really for the first time at the 4A level, and that led to them being one of the better teams in the state this year, and they spent a good chunk of the year as far as being the number two team in the state. So, again, I think a lot of that, Jake, will kind of reveal itself as to who survives the sectional round.
He's Greg Rakestraw, courtesy, again, of CarX, is with us right here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. And, Rake, I want to step, and level up, go to the college scene. We are approaching, a little bit over a month away from Selection Sunday. Indiana, Purdue, obviously Purdue, definitely in the tournament. Indiana looks to, have pretty good firm footing in the tournament as well. State of Indiana going to get another team in?
Notre Dame's looking that way, aren't they? I mean, this is the way to bring up talking about your Irish.
Maybe. I'm still not there yet.
And again, it's...
what does a mid-major scene look like? Can anybody make a run there?
From this state, no, I don't think so. Indiana State's down this year. IUPUI obviously is dreadful. Evansville is not great. Valparaiso's okay. Purdue-Fort Wayne is decent. But really, once you get outside, and obviously at this point, Butler would either have to win like the rest of their regular season games or simply get hot in the Big East tournament. So I think the one team that you look at from this state and say, hey, can they get it done? That would be Notre Dame. And again, now it's just a matter of, can you beat the right teams in the ACC, since the ACC is having a surprisingly down year?
Greg, I still can't. Greg Rakestraw is our guest. The one team in the state to me that is still the most enigmatic, because I know they're good, but I want to know if they can get the footing to become really good, and that is Indiana. Because it seems like Indiana, like you look at the impressive win over Purdue, then you turn around coming off that and you just lay a complete egg at home against Michigan. And that's kind of been the bugaboo for Indiana for like a decade now. I said that I thought they would be a 6 seed in the tournament. Latest projection I saw has them as a 7. I mean, you know, there's still 10 inches of snow outside, so it's a little early to start looking too much into that stuff. But which direction in your mind does Indiana go from here?
I think Indiana's going up. And I realize that, you know, their most recent victories have been against teams that aren't great, but they have still largely managed to avoid stepping on the banana peel, other than that game at home against Michigan. And it's not like Michigan is terrible. You know, I think of the teams that are kind of on the fringe of the tournament or just kind of on the outside looking in, they're the best of that group. Clearly, time will tell, and the next couple of weeks will tell us a lot in terms of exactly what this Indiana team is in. But I think that, again, they're clearly in now. I think they're going to stay that way. I think if you told Indiana fans that if you got to the 1st of February and you were concerned more with your seed line than saying, are you in the tournament or not, I think most Indiana fans would take that. So I think it's a 50-50 proposition, but I do think that they're trending in the right direction, let's put it that way.
Rake, with what Isaiah Thompson did in a road game, what Eric Hunter did in a road game the other night, is that Purdue showing you another gear?
Purdue's definitely got another gear. The question is, do they always get there? But my question is in terms of what Purdue can do offensively. I think it's more about what can they do defensively, what can they do to hit free throws in close games, what can they do to handle pressure. So I'm not sure if there was anything that Purdue showed me in terms of winning at Minnesota that tells me something different about their basketball team. Yes, historically, they're a team that has struggled at Minnesota, so I'm happy that they were able to kind of go to their house of horrors and actually, you know, win one. But knowing the bar is so high for this Purdue team, and we're talking about Final Four contender or national championship contender, I don't think there's anything big picture you learn by simply winning at Minnesota. And so those questions about how do you handle pressure, how do you hit free throws, how do you guard people, those are still questions we're going to learn, especially knowing just how extremely busy these next couple of weeks are because of the amount of makeup games that Purdue has to get in, playing Michigan twice in, say, the span of 6 days.
The man that does it all with us from a play-by-play standpoint, Greg Rakestraw, is with us here on Kevin and Query. Rake, given your IUPUI calling of games, you brought them up earlier. Obviously, my connection with Sean Esposito playing there, you and I have had this conversation before. I find it a bit head-scratching why IUPUI has struggled so much post-Ron Hunter. I know it's not this easy, Rake, but I consider, you know, a basketball hotbed to a degree here in Indianapolis, and from whether it's the IPS schools, the township schools, even if IUPUI got the, you know, third and fourth team guys off of those, you know, senior all-star teams from the city, they would make up, I think, a very good mid-major program, but they just aren't sniffing that. Why do you think IUPUI has struggled so much since Ron left?
It's a great question, and we're going to have an 11th consecutive season of under 500 at this point. And there was some slow progress made under Jason Gardner, and they did make a postseason berth. This would now be, 4 years ago, 3 years ago at this point, where they at least made the CIT, the College Insider Tournament. And so they were 16-16 before then losing to the team that won it in Marshall. I would assume that'd be 2019 at this juncture. But then things kind of quickly fell off the cliff at that point in time to a 7-win season. Last year's team, you know, was 8-10 in a shortened season. And last year's team, I thought, was actually pretty good. You had the young man that's playing now for the Grand Rapids Gold in the G League in Marcus Burke. The program's all-time leading rebounder in Elijah Goss, now playing professionally in Sweden. Then you had Jalen Manette, who is the all-time leader in three-pointers made in program history, who elected to grad transfer out and play at Missouri State. And just kind of a combination of factors in terms of when Matt Crenshaw was hired and what you could do from a recruiting standpoint, just completely put him behind the eight ball this year. And last night, A, God bless us for playing. B,
it was kind of a close game, right?
It was. And it was 61-55 was the final score, and it was a one-point game, about 7.5 minutes left to go. It was never double digits the entire second half, and believe me, we've not said that a lot about the IUPUI Jaguars this year, but still ended up losing by six. But IUPUI had six players in uniform last night. Jeez. And had nothing to do with the snow. Everybody got there. So it's just that's kind of the way things have shaped up in terms of roster construction, injuries, et cetera. It's just one of those years where everything that can go wrong, you know, has gone wrong. I do think the right guy is there in Matt Crenshaw. A guy that knows the program, a guy that knows the area, a guy that's been a part of Indiana college basketball, having played at IUPUI, assistant coach at IUPUI, then at Ball State the last 3 years, before then, you know, coming back home to IUPUI this past season. They've got the right guy in place, and it's you know, that's maybe not been the case over the last couple of years. So give them time, they'll be successful. This is just kind of the culmination of what's taken place the last 2 or 3 years and everything caught up with this group this season.
Greg, I feel like with IUPUI, Matt Crenshaw also, and I think maybe he's not given enough benefit of the doubt or credit for this, and that is, and I don't mean this to disparage the guys that are on the roster, but the reality is the previous administration, the previous coaching staff did not recruit well. And the university, to my understanding, did do the noble thing by saying, we're going to still honor those scholarships. So Crenshaw is probably working with some chess pieces that are not those that he would have picked for his board. Is that a fair statement?
That is absolutely spot on. And so, again, what happens is 2 years ago, you know, you have the issues with Jason Gardner, and the university elects to move on, and this happens in August. And so his top assistant coach becomes the interim head coach in Byron Rim. And again, that team was just kind of flawed in terms of its roster construction, even though it had some really individual talented pieces in terms of the guys I mentioned a couple of minutes ago that are doing well, like, you know, Burke, Manette, and Goss. But that team went 7-25. The university was going to go in a different direction in terms of the hiring process, and the pandemic hit and a hiring freeze happens. And they can't make a move. And Byron Rim agrees to come back and be an interim coach basically for a second year. But Byron's not from the area. You know, Byron's experience had been in the junior college ranks, had been in the state of Texas, had been the previous head coach at an HBCU in Prairie View A&M. And so he ends up recruiting a lot of kids from Texas. And so if you're looking at last night's game, of the six guys that played last night, four of them have ties to the state of Texas. And so it's an IUPUI team that doesn't currently have a healthy scholarship player from the state of Indiana. Now, I use that determination in healthy. I had Zach Gunn on the halftime show last night. Zach, of course, played at Hamilton Southeastern in Ball State, and frankly would have been the star player on this team from an offensive standpoint had he not torn his ACL in October. But there has not been a minute played by an Indiana kid for IUPUI this season. And that's part of the reason That's part of the reason why a coaching change was made during the course of the spring. Matt Crenshaw was bought in. The Girard twins from Mount Vernon have already signed their letter of intent. They'll be here next year. I think it'll still take a little more time to kind of reestablish those recruiting ties in the state of Indiana, but I do think it's going to happen. But yes, that is part of the process as to why it has been a struggle, and why a coaching change was made at IUPUI.
Rick, I want to sneak this one in. We just got an email from Chris. He wanted to ask you your thoughts on high school basketball with the running clock at a 35-point lead. He hates it, but he understands it. Does this rule still apply in the postseason?
I believe it would apply in the postseason up to a certain point, and I haven't thought to ask about that yet. So, like, for example, the football corollary is it applies all the way through the semi-state. It does not apply in a state championship game. You also think that, you know, in the sectional, could it happen? Yes, but rarely in the regional, semi-state, or state finals would you get to a point where it is a 35-point game at any point in time after the second half. And for those that don't know, this is the first year, and again, football's had it now for 2 or 3 years. For basketball, 35-point game at halftime or any point in time in the second half clock gets turned on. But frankly, it stops for a few more reasons in basketball than it does in football. Like, you stop on free throws, you stop for the quarter break, you know, you stop on a timeout. I didn't think it was necessary in basketball. I'm not sure I'm really for or against it. I don't think it was as necessary as you would say in football. But my assumption is that it would be just like football, it would be good through the semi-state, and then we would not have it in a state championship game.
And I know Jake's been waiting all week to ask you about the U.S. soccer 3-0,
that's right,
Trey-nil victory on the frozen pitch the other night.
Only time, by the way, in U.S. soccer history where the team scored more goals than there were actual degrees.
Right. Absolutely ridiculous they played that game in St. Paul. Again, it was a farce.
I mean, it was, what, like 2 degrees, Greg? That's, and here's the thing. I'm not saying that it was the reason the United States won. I'm not trying to discredit the United States. But to ask Honduras, to ask anybody.
They had guys leave the game with hypothermia.
Yeah, I mean, come on, man.
No, joke. Absolute joke. And so the logic behind it, other than obvious home field advantage, was that knowing they're going to be playing in Canada in the second of those three games, because it was Columbus, Hamilton, Ontario, and then St. Paul, the logic or the reasoning given by the U.S. was we wanted to reduce travel. They went from Columbus to Hamilton, Ontario, to St. Paul, Minnesota. That's the way they justified it. I think it's garbage. But the other way around that would be to have the Federation, CONCACAF, which is largely considered to be a joke for their oversight, or more importantly, lack thereof, it would simply be a matter of, hey, here's a minimum temperature that you have to meet for a World Cup qualifier, knowing you've got much warmer options in the southern half of the United States, and even in Canada, you could play indoors in Montreal or Toronto, as well as Vancouver, which is always much more moderate and temperate this time of year. So, yeah, I don't like the fact that U.S. soccer played the game there, despite the fact that it's a great facility. Those fans were wonderful. There's no reason to ever play in that thing in those type of conditions. I'll also offer you this. This is also where there would not normally be a qualifying window here. This qualifying window is being used to make up from the lack of time, from the entire process being delayed over the last couple of years because of the pandemic to get to this point. So I'm hopeful that these conditions aren't replicated ever again.
And again, the U.S. remains on track to qualify for the 2024. Is that right?
No, the World Cup will be later this year.
It's this winter, right?
2022, correct. So normally, again, this had nothing to do with the pandemic. This was all, you know, greed. But the World Cup is being played in November and December because it's being played in Qatar. Just a little warm there in terms of June and July. So the World Cup is being played in November and December. And again, that came down well before the pandemic. So that was going to happen anyway. So of all the World Cup qualifying cycles to have to use a little extra time in terms of whether you know you're going to play or not, this would be the one. Final three qualifiers are March 24th, March 27th, and March 30th. And respectively, at Mexico, home to Panama, and at Costa Rica, who are, you know, three of the other top five teams in the group, along with the U.S.
Rake, safe travels tonight. Glad you made it home safe last night, and we'll be listening. And thank you, as always, for covering it all.
You got it, bud. Thank you.
That's Greg Rakestraw right there. Again, presented by CarX, the high school hardwood rundown. Jake, let's get to a Big O Tire Sports Center update.
The Sports Center update on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan is presented by Big O Tires, the team you trust.
NBA tonight, it'll be the Pacers and the Bulls at Gainbridge Fieldhouse. Bulls coming off of a loss in Toronto in overtime. One would think that perhaps they're going to be a little worn down. DeMar DeRozan is an All-Star Game starter from Chicago. Sabonis is not an All-Star Game reserve. Is that a surprise to you?
No, individually All-Star-like numbers, but when your team is ranked 13th in a 15-team Eastern Conference, you are not going to get benefit of the doubt. So yeah, he does not deserve it, unfortunately. First time since 2014-2015, the Pacers haven't had an All-Star. That was the Paul George broken leg year. Lance Stephenson did sign a contract yesterday through the rest of this season. So Lance Stephenson will be a member of the Pacers. It's just a, you know, 1 year, I guess I should say, more like a 3-month deal, Jake. He'll be a free agent next year.
The Eastern Reserves, Darius Garland of Cleveland, Toronto's Fred Van Fleet, Jimmy Butler of Miami, James Harden of Brooklyn, Zach LaVine of the Bulls, Chris Middleton, who may not play tonight, by the way, Zach LaVine, Chris Middleton of Milwaukee, and Jason Tatum of Boston. They will be joining the Eastern All-Star starters, which, again, these get, like, divided up into the teams coached by LeBron and Kevin Durant. But DeMar DeRozan, Trae Young, Joel Embiid, Kevin Durant, Giannis, the Eastern Conference All-Stars, no Domas Sabonis.
You heard Darius Greg Rakestraw. Garland, that's a nice name.
Good player. Have you seen him play?
Yeah. The Colin Sexton injury, Darius Garland from Vanderbilt's been really key in Cleveland being a playoff team.
You remember Darius Garland and Romeo Langford when they were in high school. There was a lot of discussion.
Right?
Yeah, and there was a lot of thought from Indiana fans that Darius Garland and Langford were going to come to IU together, and instead Bryce Drew got him to Vanderbilt where he got hurt right away. Didn't play much, but he's had a nice... And Cleveland's playing well.
Right. Interesting roster construction. Again, the Sexton injury has been big for them, but somehow Kevin Love is still on their roster, and they continue to be, or they've really improved to be a playoff team this year.
You heard Greg Rakestraw talking about IUPUI last night losing to Youngstown State 61-55. Jags now 2-18. College basketball coming up tomorrow. It will be Illinois and Indiana at noon. That is the same time as the tip for St. John's and Butler. Also, Robert Morris and IUPUI tomorrow at noon. Michigan and Purdue, a 2:30 tip for the Boilermakers at 19-3. So busy day tomorrow in college basketball.
Busy day, certainly. All three of those games in Indiana, I would assume travel-wise, everything, you know, those respective road teams can get to, West Lafayette, Bloomington, Indy today, but that'll be something to keep an eye on. So I think last night we had Ohio State, Iowa maybe was postponed, one of the Big Ten games. Was postponed. And did you get clarity on your Cowboys? Did they play last night?
Yeah, Wyoming played last night and beat Boise State, and ESPN.com is still listing it as postponed.
No respect from the worldwide leader.
Get on it, man.
With your Cowboys.
They're in control in the Mountain West now. They knock off Boise State and hand Boise State their first loss in the conference. Big win for the Pokes, man.
No respect whatsoever with Wyoming. All right, we come back here on Kevin and Query. We will update you on the latest NFL head coaching search that has been filled. And get back to that Josh McDaniels conversation. In 4 years, Josh McDaniels still head coaching the Raiders or Frank Reich still head coaching the Colts?
It's a good question.
Debate that next here on Kevin and Query.
Join 93.1 WIBC right down the dial for IU basketball this Saturday at 11 a.m. for the pregame show as the Fighting Illini of Illinois take on the Hoosiers. Tip-off is 12 noon.
And bring home a new mortgage this Valentine's Day. TheHomeLoanExpert.com.
NMLS number 1326241.
Turn to the experts at Howald Heating and Carrier for all your heating needs. Howald Heating, Air, and Plumbing, where coming home never felt so good. Online at HowaldHeatingandAir.com.
February only has 28 days, which is why Big O Tires is giving you all month long to save on sets of select Michelin brand tires. Earn a $70 reward card with installation purchase, plus an additional $120 in mail-in rebate savings on purchases of $500 or more on your Big O Tires credit card. Big O knows that tires and auto repair can be an unexpected expense. That's why they have financing tailored for you. Big O is more than just tires. Come in for brakes, alignments, oil changes, fluids, batteries, and more. Schedule your appointment today at BigOTires.com. Big O Tires, the team you trust.
When it comes to working at Geico, our best advocates are our employees, like Justina. But since she is so focused on growing her career, we hired an actor to read her story.
At Geico, I receive support from those above me. If you want to move up, you really have that relationship and encouragement.
As a full-time employee, she can even get paid training and tuition reimbursement. Yep, there's no stopping her now. She's even taking over book club.
Ready to start your career, Indy? We're hiring claim sales and service agents. Apply online today at geico.job/Indy.
Winter storms? Get to pay less liquors. Stock up on Old Forester 86 proof, 1.75 liter bottles, just $29.99. Grey Goose 80 proof 175s are $39.99, and Crown Royal 750s in the purple bag, $22.99. Get a jump on Valentine's and pay less with Fireball's Anti-Valentine Hearts, only $8.99, plus Behringer White Zin is $2.99 a bottle. And if you like Willet Pot Still Bourbon, the East Street Payless Liquor Store has a limited supply now. Payless has 26 family-owned locations, open 7 days a week, and online at paylessliquors.com. Don't pay more, get more, pay less at Payless Liquors.
With PatriotSoftware.com, accounting and payroll, keep your time and money.
Mike Cappell here, serial entrepreneur. We entrepreneurs are always improving our listening skills. My dad told me at age 29, Michael, you're a man now. You're about to be married. You have responsibilities. You'd be a fool to start your own business.
I did what any loving son would do. I started five of them. I didn't listen to my dad, but I have learned to listen to my customers, which is why my fifth successful business, Patriot Software, created accounting software to help non-accountants like me keep accurate accounting records. Go to patriotsoftware.com. Use promo code RADIO and get 2 months of accounting software free. That's patriotsoftware.com.
Patriotsoftware.com. Accounting and payroll. Keep your time and money.
Bet Rivers Sportsbook wants you to experience Rush Pay. When you want to cash out your winnings, you don't want to wait 2 days just to get the go-ahead to withdraw your money. That's why Bet Rivers created Rush Pay. With Rush Pay, 80% of withdrawal requests are approved instantly, meaning you'll get your money faster. Why wait? Get your cash when you want it. Bet with a winner. Bet with Bet Rivers Sportsbook at BetRivers.com. Must be 21 and located in Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. 1-800-994-8448.
The Ride with JMV.
Race Trash, anything goes, 239-1070. Line 5 is on the air, welcome to the show. Who's this?
It's Butch.
Butch, how are you?
My wife listens to your show.
That's great.
When I have it on YouTube, and she thinks you're absolutely gorgeous hunk of man and loves your passion.
Butch, everybody, that's how you end.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays, 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
I got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, baby, when I turn it on.
It's all Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Flying up, no
ceiling when we Kevin Bowen, Jake Querry here. Josh Bolinex on the big board. Is there any more satisfying feeling? By the way, just so folks know, if you're just getting up and about, this is the first time in probably 48 hours that when I look outside, I can see like across the way. You always use the Riley Towers as the barometer, right?
I can see it all.
It is clear outside and the sky looks clear. I mean, there was some thought there was going to be snow this morning. If that's the case, I mean, it looks really clear out right now.
Yeah. We'll see how much the melting happens.
Well, that's going to be the challenge.
It's going to be pretty cold, right? But again, our commutes this morning, not too bad at all. Granted, not a lot of traffic when Jake and I were driving in this morning. So certainly expect some sort of delay, but I don't think anything too severe on that front.
I find the most satisfying feeling in the world. There's just this incredible, I want to know if I'm the only person that ever experiences this, okay?
I'm nervous.
I wonder
when you get in a saltwater pool.
I've never been in a saltwater pool. Now they have that over here. Now, didn't you say, Josh, that Tony Katz was doing a cannonball contest at the saltwater pool at the Hilton Garden Inn? Right?
It was electric.
Isn't that right? All the producers staying over there.
Yeah, can opener time.
That's
Mr.
right,
Katz.
I want to know if I'm the only one who finds this incredible satisfaction and like cleansing feeling when I'm able to kick knock free the large clump of snow and ice on my wheel well. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, actually do.
When that bad boy falls off and you're like, hell yes. And then you're like, wait a minute, I'm going to have to back out over that, I think.
So when I parked in the garage today, I noticed it coming in here.
Oh, yeah.
This morning. And I thought to myself, you know what? There's a chance that might naturally fall off in the next 3 hours. So I'm going to hold off.
No kick?
On that feeling. No kick.
Well, there's nothing worse than when you try to kick it and it's actually frozen solid.
Yeah.
That's a bit of a buzzkill.
Then your toe hurts and you need QC kinetics.
When that bad boy falls in one fell swoop, it is like, it is the greatest, right?
You know the time of year, or I should say, you know the year we had no snow this time of year was about a decade ago with the Super Bowl being here. And I think that's what Steve
10 years ago tomorrow
wanted to chat about. Steve, you want to talk a little Super Bowl?
Yeah, you know, it was 10 years ago, and I tell you, if you want a quality recap of it, there's an up-and-coming sports writer in the Indianapolis Monthly who's really has a great article about it.
The one and only Derek Schultz, I believe?
That may be the individual. But, you know, 10 years later, I still regret not going down the zip line. There was like a short line, and I said, I'll walk around the Super Bowl Village for a little bit and come back and get on the zip line. And it was like trying to go to the trough at the Speedway during a pit stop.
I'll tell you what, man. Steve, I remember the zip line. Did you do the zip line, Kevin?
I did not, know.
I walked up to the top, and I was all excited to do the zip line. And what you don't realize about the zip line, it was like skydiving. It took a while for me to get that push off, right? I'm like,
and remind me again where exactly it was located.
It was on Capitol, basically along the line of the main entrance to the convention center.
Okay.
It was awesome. It was very cool. Once you got going, man, it was the best. It was awesome. Look, the Super Bowl 10 years ago, everything fell into line for the city of Indianapolis. The weather was perfect. The game was obviously good. You had Peyton Manning, the whole question mark about Peyton Manning's future, but his little brother playing here, kind of a passing of the torch in that regard to an extent.
Great halftime show.
The Madonna, right?
Yes.
Was the halftime show. Mm-hmm. And that was, I will say, and we were very lucky to do it. I was doing an afternoon radio show and was on Radio Row for that week at the convention center each day. And that week was the, and I've never been fatigued in what we do. I don't think what we do is by any stretch labor or a job or hard. That was the most fatigued I've ever been. It was just a nonstop whirlwind of activity every day. It just felt like walking into a headwind in a good way. And I remember walking around, Kevin, downtown and seeing all these people lined up to go into the Bud Light Hotel, which was the Hampton Inn. They turned it into, you know, for marketing purposes. And just walking around and thinking, I can't believe this. You know, I recalled as a kid growing up getting Linder's ice cream on Sundays and my parents driving us downtown to see the building of downtown and see the building of the AUL building and then later the building of the Hoosier Dome. And why, and then going down and sitting down for like 4 hours on a Sunday to watch the Hoosier Dome inflate. And I'm like, here I am with the Super Bowl in the city of Indianapolis. Now, I have my own totally different talk show discussion on the economic impact or the money lost. I think Indianapolis, you know, there was a lot of discussion and thought that the power of it would go well beyond the central quarter, the central nucleus of downtown, and it did not. You know, there were businesses in Broaderport on the north side that I think thought they were going to cash in on the Super Bowl being here. And unfortunately, they didn't because everything was so epicenter and it was so, and there was no reason to go anywhere other than just walk around downtown, which is what people ended up doing. The city lost money on it. I mean, the city lost $1 million on having the Super Bowl, but the prestige of it and the fact that we're able to talk about it was pretty darn cool.
I might be in the minority here, Jake, but I think Indy will get another Super Bowl.
That's possible. I think it depends on. Here is the thing.
The college football national championship wanted to come here. That was not a bidding process. Okay. I mean, that's pretty high standard.
Here is my understanding or opinion on this. Right now, what is the oldest stadium in the National Football League currently?
Bills Stadium. I have no idea.
Okay, that's probably in the ballpark, right? Or Arrowhead. I mean, you know, one of those. Two things here, Kevin, and I'll try to do it briefly. But when the Colts, when Lucas Oil Stadium was built, the city of Indianapolis was people were terrified that the Colts were going to move to Los Angeles. It was never going to happen. Never going to happen. And the reason why it was never going to happen, and the reason why, and I give the Colts credit, they were smart about it, but the Colts masterfully penned the city of Indianapolis and the taxpayers of Indianapolis into a sweetheart deal because people were worried about losing the Colts and what that would mean to the city of Indianapolis. The reason the Colts could not move to Los Angeles, number one, I don't know that Jim Irsay truly wanted to do that. I think he has made a concerted effort to be a dedicated owner to this market, but it was floated out there, and the reason it was floated out there was in order to get that deal. But at that time, when the Baltimore Colts moved to Indianapolis, it was such an unpopular move by Bob Irsay, ironically enough, that instituted within the league a rule that in order for a franchise to relocate, they had to get approval from 80% of the rest of the league, 80% of the other owners. So if there are, 32 teams? So if you're going to move, you have to get the thumbs up from at least 25 owners. Well, at the time the Colts were discussing getting a new stadium and moving from the RCA Dome, there were still Minnesota, the Cowboys, the Saints with renovation, the Rams, there were all these teams that were trying to get new finances for new stadiums or renovations within their respective city, and they knew that they also had L.A. as their wild card. L.A. having no team was the wild card, and there's no coincidence in the fact that no team moved into Los Angeles until every owner's needs had been met. Then once everybody had, once Minnesota had a new stadium, and once Jacksonville had renovation to their stadium, and Indianapolis had a new stadium, and Dallas had a new stadium, and Phoenix had a new stadium, and the Giants had a new stadium, then, okay, now anybody want to go to LA? Go ahead, because we don't need it as the trump card anymore. And so for that same reason, I could see Indianapolis getting back into the Super Bowl mix because the NFL has incentivized four markets. If you build a new stadium, we'll bring a Super Bowl to you because they want the newest best for their owners. But all of those new stadiums now have been built in this cycle. So I could see, in fact, Indianapolis being back in the mix of that.
Yeah, and two things for me, Jake. I don't think it should leave here, but it sounds like the combine, this could be it for it.
Correct.
So that, I think,
we'll scratch right, your back, hey, back Indy, kind of thing.
We feel right. bad about that. And I do think a Midwest rotation, one every 10 years, makes sense to me. You know, a couple of years ago, they're in Minneapolis. If you look at since that Super Bowl and what's coming up, I think it's Arizona next year, if I'm not mistaken. They're not getting back to the Midwest anytime soon. 2026, I believe, is the next open date for a Super Bowl. So I would think a Midwest rotation.
If you had to do a rotation, if they called you, the NFL calls you, Kevin, and says, we want to do a rotation of Super Bowl host cities of five, and one of them is, to make it interesting, we'll do a cold weather. Number. Eight. We'll go eight.
Can I play outdoors in cold weather?
Oh, absolutely. Ooh. Well, they did it in New York, right?
Yeah, I forgot about that. Lambeau.
Ooh, okay.
Dallas.
Okay.
L.A.
Okay.
Miami.
Yep.
I don't need to have multiple in Florida.
Okay.
New Orleans.
Phoenix.
Phoenix, Indy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's seven. That leaves room for a, I mean, Indy slash Minneapolis.
Minneapolis is cool.
You know, do you need to go to New York?
Lambeau is tough just strictly because of the hotels and accommodations in Green Bay.
I know. That's far-fetched.
I love Milwaukee. Don't get me wrong, but it's 2 hours away.
Detroit gets a new stadium.
I mean, Detroit's up there. I'm not a huge fan of the city of Detroit, but I just don't think there's a lot to do.
Yeah, and we aren't in a rotation.
You know where would be a cool Super Bowl? If you were going to do a cold weather, an outdoor cold weather Super Bowl, Arrowhead would be cool.
Oh, yeah. Love that. Will there be a London Super Bowl in the Jake Query lifetime?
Well, Kev, the rate we're going, the lifetime of Jake Query might be in the next 2.5 years, right? I mean, need I remind you?
This show, yeah, I said Josh McDaniels or Frank Reich, which one will last longer? Will this show or your life
last longer? If I live to be 80, that would give me 31 years. No, I don't believe so. Do you think so?
I don't, but 31 years is a long time, Jake.
It is. And I mean, I will admit, 31 years ago,
I don't, but. Well, we have a London franchise in your lifetime.
Now, that I could see. I mean, I think it's entirely possible.
We get to 48 NFL teams at some point?
I think it's more likely in my lifetime that we have a Super Bowl that is London against Toronto.
We're still having a franchise in Buffalo?
Yes.
That's always the big kind of...
I know, but I think Buffalo now has kind of cemented themselves, at least for another generation. What about London versus Mexico City? I think that's entirely possible, too.
If the NFL expanded to 48 teams, would Carson Wentz have a statue in front of one of those 48 stadiums?
Team 48 would be doing... There'd be phone calls, right? If the NFL expanded to 48 teams, News Talk Radio in Cedar Rapids right now would be people going, I don't think Carson's the guy. I don't think so.
When we come back here on Kevin Aquari, Joe Wiz, a busy college basketball weekend, some intriguing games even outside of the state. Duke, Carolina, their first matchup this year. And we'll talk a little early Super Bowl props with Joe Wiz. Coming up next here on 93.5-107.5, The Fan.
Are you ready to hit the road, take to the sky, or set sail this year, next year, or beyond? Then plan to attend the AAA Vacation Expo on Saturday, February 12th at the JW Marriott. Exclusive vacation deals, expert presentations, complimentary travel planning, and more. Best part? It's free. You don't even have to be a AAA member to attend. Don't miss your chance to find the best price on your new vacation Saturday, February 12th at the AAA Vacation Expo. For more details, visit AAA.com/expo.
The big game is finally here, and Prop Swap has hundreds of tickets listed at the best odds in the country. Just a reminder, on Prop Swap, it's the only place in Indiana where you can buy and sell sports bets while sitting on your couch. You can buy and sell throughout a season, throughout a game, throughout a tournament. That is some of the beauty of Prop Swap. They are so accessible to you whenever you feel good or bad about the ticket that you might have. And bettors from across the country are cashing in on their championship futures right now. Like you had Jamie from New York who sold a $100 25-1 Bengals Super Bowl ticket for $1,000. The buyer got great odds, and Jamie made 10 times his money before the big game on Sunday, February 13th. So if you're looking for better odds on what's available right now, head to PropSwap for a better ticket. If you're looking for better odds on what your sportsbook is offering, look no further. PropSwap is your answer. Head to PropSwap.com or download the free PropSwap app today.
Feeling the pinch of higher prices?
Golden Oak Lending can save you money with their low 2.25% rate.
James Hawkins here, president of Golden Oak. Offset high prices with lower monthly payments or turn your home equity into cash.
Lock in this low rate while you can. Call 317-706-GOLD today.
Golden Oak Lending, cured my blues.
NMLS 114937, 2.25% fixed, 3.336% APR, FHA 15-year mortgage with 20% equity and approved credit.
Hey, it's Big Joe for your trusted local independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer, B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains. Co-owner Beth Rovazzini says one huge benefit has come from recent events.
Online training. We can take all of our staff every morning for an hour before they go out on calls, get that training in. They're all together, so you have that benefit that they're talking to each other and sharing that information. And that's been one of the best things that came out of COVID.
Put that training to work at BigBlackTrucks.com. B&W is your trusted local independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer.
Did you know Amazon provides ways of working that fit your lifestyle? They know you value your time outside of work, juggling family, school, friends, or other activities. That's why they offer a variety of shifts that work for you. There are full-time, part-time, and even temporary opportunities that can work with your schedule, with great starting pay and sign-on bonuses. If you want a career that fits and adapts to your lifestyle, head to Amazon.com/apply. Amazon is a proud equal opportunity employer.
Rattle, rattle, thunder, clatter, boom, boom, boom.
Don't worry, call the CarX man.
CarX is the best in brakes, and they'll prove it to you. Right now, a lifetime guarantee comes with a new set of brake pads for just $109.99 per axle. Enjoy the peace of mind that comes with lifetime brake pads at a great price. Installed at just $109.99 per axle at CarX Tire and Auto. The best in brakes.
Don't worry, call the CarX man.
Hi, this is Ryan Newman, NASCAR Cup Series driver and champion for a great cause, driven to save lives and organ donation. Look, what I do is dangerous and nobody's invincible, but we can all do something incredible to save the lives of others. That's why I want you to take a moment and register yourself as an organ donor, like me, at driventosavelives.org. You might just become somebody's real hero.
Here's what's happening with the fan.
JMV gives away Night Ranger tickets all week, 3 to 6 p.m. Listen to call in for your chance to see the band perform next week at the Paramount in Anderson. Think you have the best sports trivia knowledge? Listen to Kevin and Query from 7 to 10 a.m. and call into the pop quiz for your chance at a Jiffy Lube prize pack. And follow the fan on social media. The fan is on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Like and follow the fan for updates, giveaways, and all things sports.
For more info, click on 1075thefan.com.
Kansas hosts Baylor and Carolina takes on Duke in a college hoops doubleheader. Tomorrow at 3:30 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Saturday and Sunday mornings, the fine line with Joe Wiz. We'll ask him some early Super Bowl thoughts, but do want to begin with college basketball. Joe, it's a pretty good Saturday here in the state. A lot of matchups home-wise, Indiana, Purdue, Butler all at home. But nationally, Baylor at Kansas, Duke at North Carolina, pretty good marquee games nationally too.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me on. Good morning. And wow, I really, you know, everyone's all panicking because it's the first week where there's no football since August, but I love it. There's 145 college basketball games tomorrow. That's 145 opportunities to try and make some money. We got a couple of NBA games. And as you mentioned, there's a lot of great college basketball games right in your local area. Of course, the big one starts right at noon Eastern time in Bloomington with the Hoosiers and Fighting Illini.
Are you betting on the Pro Bowl, Joe?
No, I'm not. If you need the Pro Bowl, I have a phone number for a psychiatrist for you. There's some things you just stay away from. I mean, guys,
is there a line on it?
I'm sorry?
Is there a line on it?
No, they put lines up there, but they're really not bettable because, you know, there's so much stuff going on with the games here. I mean, at Bet Rivers, the line has AFC favored by one and a total at 62.5. If you must, only if you must, bet the over. Just hope it's a high-scoring game.
You know, Joe, the reality is in college basketball, you know, I look at, for example, Kentucky going into Allen Fieldhouse and just laying it to Kansas, and Kansas is really good, right? And, you know, last night, Arizona and UCLA, there's a lot of parity in college basketball, seemingly more so than in years past. Am I wrong there, or is this, in fact, a real challenge for you in trying to determine safe plays?
Well, with 145 games on a board, for instance, for tomorrow, there is some opportunities to make money. You don't necessarily have to get involved with the marquee games. I mean, you know, look at this game here that's going on right in Bloomington tomorrow. Indiana's taking on Illinois. This is a great game, okay? It goes right out at noontime. Both teams come in with a record of 16-5. And the Fighting Illini, like I said, they beat Indiana 3 straight. But the Hoosiers play really well at home. They've already beaten Purdue, and they've beaten Ohio State, and they're going to knock off the Illini tomorrow morning. At noontime to start out the day, I'm picking Indiana to knock off the Illini.
There you go. I haven't seen a line on that, but I would expect it to be pretty close to a pick 'em there. Joe Wiz, the Fine Line, 8 a.m. Saturday and Sunday mornings right here on The Fan, is with us right now. Joe, let's look ahead to the Super Bowl. I've seen the line kind of hover right around 4. At times I've seen it at 4.5. That would be the Rams favored. The over-under, I'm seeing 48.5. Your early thoughts before we ask you about some player props or just some game props on that line and the over-under.
Yeah, at Bet Rivers, which is the sponsor of the Fine Line, my show will be on tomorrow morning at 8 a.m. I'll be breaking down a lot of the college basketball games, some NBA games. We'll be talking about the Super Bowl as well. And anyone who wants to get some free winners can follow me on Instagram or Twitter, Joe Wiz Sports. But getting to the Super Bowl, Super Bowl 56 at SoFi, yeah, you take a look at it here. Cincinnati, how about them? They beat the Kansas City Chiefs twice. The Rams, they struggled. I mean, I had San Francisco last week, so even though the Rams are playing, I'm still happy I won with San Francisco. So no lead is safe. That's what we do know in the playoffs, okay? This has been the most exciting playoffs in recent history. And, you know, when you take a look at it, the Bengals, they've trailed 21-3 at Arrowhead and overcame that deficit here. Now, you know, one thing here we have to make sure is that somehow Burrow has to get protected here. I mean, because when he played at Tennessee, he was sacked 9 times. If he gets sacked 9 times by Donald, I don't think he's going to get up.
What about the, in terms of the prop bets, which to you, Joe, are the most fun or the ones that you say, you know what, I kind of like the sound of this one. I think it's a pretty good one to look into.
I'm going with heads. No, I'm only kidding. Heads. But Burrow, MVP, you could get plus 225, okay? It's not a bad deal if Burrow has a good game. Cooper Kupp, worth taking a shot, plus 600 at Bet Rivers. You know, Kupp is going to be right there. You know, Rams, over, under, 26.5. That's a little high there. The total game is at 48.5. But, you know, the games that have been played so far, defense has been the situation here. Cincinnati, KC went under 27-24. Tennessee, 19-16, under. Same thing when they played the Raiders. So a lot of people don't give the Bengals defense any credit. And, you know, their defense has been good as well. But, you know, they're going to be up against the Rams, who have the number one pass rushing D and have 53 sacks. So Burrow's probably, you know, going to have a couple sleepless nights here. But I think if they can protect him, this game could be competitive and maybe more.
Joe, I can't wait to break it down more with you next Friday, and then obviously this weekend. Can get a little extra money in the bank with all the college basketball action leading into the Super Bowl a week from Sunday. Again, Joe Wiz, The Fine Line, 8 a.m. tomorrow, 8 a.m. again on Sunday, right here on 107.5 The Fan. Joe, have a great weekend.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate it.
That's Joe Wiz right there on the Payless Liquors Hotline. We come back here on Kevin and Query, the final hour. We'll talk a little bit more about the Super Bowl and get into the Josh McDaniels debate as well. Kevin and Query on a Friday.
The Ride with JMV.
So now the defensive line coach is not coming back. Matt Eberflus has got the head coaching gig in Chicago. So regardless of who's the next defensive coordinator, maybe it's Jim Schwartz, maybe not, but who is going to get the blame now? Now do we thoroughly look, as we should, at the player personnel decisions of Chris Ballard? Absolutely.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Sports Center updates on The Fan are brought to you by Big O Tires. Stop by your locally owned and operated Big O Tires and get a $70 rewards card upon purchase of select sets of Michelin tires. Big O Tires, the team you trust.
Sign up for BetMGM and find out why they are the king of parlays. Use one game parlay to make multiple selections within a single game from hundreds of betting options. How about supercharging your payout for even more winnings? Well, try Parlay Boost. Or maybe you're fearless and want to take a shot at Parlay Generator. Sign up on the BetMGM app or website using the bonus code THEFAN, all one word, capital T, capital F, and your first bet will be risk-free up to $1,000. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. 21 years of age or older to wager. Indiana only. New customer offer. All promotions are subject to qualification and eligibility requirements. Rewards issued as non-withdrawable free bets or site credit. Free bets expire 7 days from issuance. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem and wants help, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Hey, Dr. Jenner, what do you remember most about playing high school sports?
Oh, I loved it. I made friends and have memories I'll treasure forever. But what mattered most were the life lessons I learned in the soccer field.
Life lessons. Which are your favorite?
Just being part of a team. You learn so many valuable skills. Collaboration, communication, work ethic. These are just some of the lessons that have helped shape the person I am to this day. I'm Dr. Katie Jenner, Indiana Secretary of Education.
And I'm Paul Knight, Commissioner of the Indiana High School Athletic Association. Join us in celebrating the 50th anniversary of Title IX and the opportunities it's provided female student athletes across this country, including here in Indiana.
Thanks to Title IX, generations of female student athletes have learned life lessons that will impact them for the rest of their lives.
And that is a legacy we're celebrating.
This is 50 years of Title IX. This is celebrating generations of female student athletes. This is your IHSAA.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
Join me today. We're going to talk about the weekend that's coming up. We got the Pacers. We got IU. We got Purdue. We got college hoops in full swing. Join me today. Let's talk about it, baby.
It's Kevin and Query.
If we die, we die together.
Yeah, right.
You can get it done. You can get it done. What's more, you gotta get it done.
On 93.5.
Boom, baby!
107.5. The Fan.
Final hour here of the show on a Friday. Jake Query along with Kevin Bowen. Josh Mullinex here as well, in for Mark Dykton, who will be back next week. Again, roads right now, looking out, all I can see is Meridian and Monument Circle, but they've done a nice job clearing them out. Give yourself a little extra time. It's going to be cold all day, but the good news is it looks like, at least for now, the precipitation has stopped. Kevin, we talked about this earlier, but I think it's a really good conversation that you had mentioned. Josh McDaniels, Frank Reich, which is more likely to be coaching their team that they are currently coaching, let's say, 3 to 4 years from now?
Before I forget, you said to meet you where to sled around 11:30. Where are we sledding after the show?
You want to go to Butler?
Okay.
The Butler Hill?
Butler. You bringing a saucer sled? What are you going with?
Toboggan.
Toboggan. Gotcha. Toboggan. All
That's right.
Cool. All right. I will meet you just outside of the Butler Bowl. Is that where you're thinking?
You know, there used to be the big hill at Butler. There still is one over there, right?
Yeah, but I'm thinking, does the hill kind of bump into the football field over
that's
there?
That's the problem now, right?
There's a concrete barrier. Ooh. It's
well, that
it's
seems
not quite
to be a
curb.
Bit of a detriment.
It's not quite a curb, but it is like a border of the football field, and you do have to go over it. So hopefully there's some padding.
I saw Taylor Tannenbaum and Dave Calabro went sledding yesterday at Butler.
Well, it was a good time. I saw they went around the track with Doug Bowles.
Yeah, oh yeah. Doug Bowles was snowboarding.
Yeah. That looked awesome. The staples for me up in Carmel back in the day, Cool Creek. You ever been up there to see like a concert? They got an amphitheater area.
No, but you said there's a golf course. Is that the...
Well, the golf course in Noblesville, which is unreal, is Forest Park, the ninth hole, par three, uphill, unbelievable hole there. And then Brookshire Golf Course, 116th and Gray, 14th hole, slide down that. Oh, yeah. I've got vivid memories of that.
They let you do that? Country Club Heights in Shelbyville, right across the street from the Elks. The Elks had some good sledding in Shelbyville.
I think if just enough of you show up, they can't say no to everybody,
that's
right?
That's probably true. You know? That's how you live your life, right?
Pretty much. Okay, Josh McDaniels, Frank Reich. Who is the head coach of their respective football teams in 2025? Wow. I'm shocked McDaniels took the job, Jake, just because you're in that division. I mean, Mahomes and Herbert? And we'll see what Denver does. I'm not as anti-McDaniels as I think 95% of our listening audience is.
Something happened, Kevin, when Josh McDaniels backed out here. Either he was told by Bill Belichick that he was going to be handed the keys within a certain number of years, and then Mac Jones changed that timeline, or something happened that caused him to get cold feet in Indianapolis at the last minute about the Colts themselves. If you had to bet, which of those two would it be?
It's a great question. I'd say the former. Josh McDaniels took the job in Denver, Jake, at the age of 33. He is now 45 or 6. Can you speak to maturity from 33 to 45 or 46?
Yeah, I mean...
I just think we just write him off as like, he's an ass, he treated Colts fans bad, look what happened in Denver. It wasn't horrific in Denver. They went 500 his first year. They didn't have a quarterback. The greatest winner in NFL history seems to respect him.
I think, here's what I think happened.
I just think he's in the wrong division.
Yeah, well, no doubt. Here's what I think happened. I think that Josh McDaniels was ready to take the job in Indianapolis with Bill Belichick's blessing. And it's always difficult to move on from your mentor. I remember, Kevin, I was mentoring, if you will, interning, whatever you want to call it, under Ed Sorensen at Channel 6, and I'd been hanging around there forever, doing whatever needed to be done. And finally, one day, Ed said to me, look, are you just going to hang around here forever, or are you finally going to like spread your wings and go out and like get a job, like, you know, and put to use everything you've learned, or are you afraid? And that was kind of the push I needed, and so I went out and ventured out and got a job, right? And then ultimately found my way back to Channel 6. But so I know what that's like, kind of that hesitation of getting out of that comfort zone. Josh McDaniels did that in Denver. We saw what happened. But he's always been thought of as a Belichick guy. I think when Indianapolis came open and he accepted that job, I think that it's entirely possible that Bill Belichick said to him, you know, Belichick sees him packing up his office and then realizes, well, wait a minute, like I'm getting ready to potentially go into an era without Tom Brady. And here's my offensive whisperer. And it's going to be tough sledding for me to do this without Josh McDaniels there to help me navigate the transition into a new offensive era. So I think Belichick goes to him and says, listen, Josh, if you stick around here, we can have it done where this, the understanding that you take over the kingdom when I ride off in the sunset, which is not far away. Let's get the transition going. Let's figure out what we want to do, and then I'm going to ride off in the sunset. And that transition ultimately ended up, you know, Cam Newton, no. But they get Mac Jones, who has a Brady-like look about him. I don't mean that he's going to win 7 Super Bowls. I just mean he's a composed, smart, poised quarterback.
I thought you meant actual look, so I was like, wow, that's high praise no. for Mac Jones.
So
Brady's pretty good looking.
So I think Belichick looks at it and then says, you know what? I might stick around a little longer than I thought. I mean, we were in the playoffs in this kid's rookie year, and I've got some pieces here. And so then I think Josh McDaniels sees that writing on the wall and says, you know what? So instead of like a 3 to 4 year, 5 year promise, it might be another 5. So I'm better off. And what better place to go than a place that does have a good quarterback in Derek Carr outside of the division? I mean, you're living in Las Vegas. You're living in Henderson, Nevada. It's a cool area. The weather's great. The franchise has history and a great fan base. So I think it just came down to timing.
You got a team with a lot of off-the-field issues this past year, though, Jake. I mean, I am not like this anti McDaniels, you know, he's just a, you know, he's an ass and we hate him. He's a snake. He's from the evil empire, blah, blah, blah. I'm not that, but I just think he's walking into a very difficult situation outside of really his quarterback, just because the division is so tough and it doesn't look like that's stopping anytime soon. I didn't realize this, Jake, until I started looking into the whole Jim Harbaugh Vikings thing, just how good Harbaugh was in San Francisco.
Yes. In terms of college coaches that have turned NFL coaches, he is the best, right?
I mean, he was on track to have a Hall of Fame NFL head coaching career.
I believe he has, of the last like 25 years, coaches that transitioned from college to the NFL, I believe he has the top winning percentage.
4 years in San Fran. 13 wins, 11 wins, 12, and 8 wins. 3 of those 4 years, playoff appearances. The Super Bowl runner-up in one of those years. And they lost in the NFC title game. His two other playoff appearances.
And that's without the Super Bowl run is without his starting quarterback, right? Because didn't Alex Smith get hurt and they handed it over to Colin Kaepernick?
I felt like Kaepernick was playing at a pretty high level.
He did.
But still.
I like Colin Kaepernick's game. Yeah. I always did.
44-19-1, his NFL record.
It's pretty legit, right? I think that.
You think he's really going to be a lifer at Michigan?
No.
I mean, he was telling recruits like, you know, the Super Bowl is kind of the missing ingredient. Like, he was being, it sounds like, very honest and upfront with them about his, you know, pursuit of an NFL job. I think he will be an NFL coach in the next 5 years.
I think the NFL is probably where he wants to be, right? Speaking of Harbaugh, you know, Harbaugh's an eccentric guy. Did you see that what is Brian Kelly doing at LSU? These videos.
Yeah, he's grinding on recruits, Jake.
That didn't end up going there.
Yeah.
I saw that video and I'm like, wait a minute.
Have you seen the photo splice of the Urban Meyer grind? And
yes.
Brian Kelly grind? Very similar. Yeah, very similar.
So for those that are unfamiliar, the LSU football program on social media posted a produced video of Brian Kelly and a football player in an all LSU uniform.
Dancing on a 17-year-old teenager.
Correct. I mean, they are dancing as if they're like in a club, right? To music and strobe lights or whatever else. When I saw that, I just assumed that was like the LSU football captain or something, and it was like a hype video to get people excited for the upcoming. Then I find out that was a recruit. That wasn't even, I mean, this is apparently Brian Kelly's like recruiting pitch to players.
A recruit that ended up committing to Alabama.
Correct. He didn't even end up going to LSU.
God, that's awkward. It's like watching the video, Jake, I feel like I'm hearing nails on a chalkboard.
Totally. Very strange.
Ray wanted to talk about Indianapolis hosting a Super Bowl. Good Friday morning to you, Ray.
Hey, Kevin. I actually got two questions here today this morning. My first question was, do you think the location of Lucas Oil being so close to bars and being so close to hotels and walking distance would play a factor in Indianapolis being chosen for the next Super Bowl?
Yeah, I think it's a great draw. I think Jake's mentioned it. The appeal of the walkability, especially in a cold weather climate, I would say is arguably Indianapolis' biggest draw. I mean, a lot of these Super Bowls, you look at the Super Bowl in San Francisco, the Santa Clara is where that stadium is. That's 45 minutes outside of where their city and airport's located.
Yeah, and my second question here, Kevin, is with Doug Peterson being hired, doesn't that mean we have to keep Wentz just for the parody of it?
Thank you for that, Ray. Remember when Doug Peterson came to Colts training camp last year, Jake?
Yeah.
Do you remember that? And I was like, oh, boy, gosh, is Carson Wentz going to shake his hand? Is Carson Wentz going to acknowledge him? What did they – Doug Peterson, Frank Reich had a couple walks in the Monon.
Really?
He came here for a couple days, and they exchanged.
What part of the Monon do we know?
Well, pretty far north.
By the way, is Ray still on the line, Josh?
Grand Park.
Hey, Ray, you sound like a nice fella. Can we do a little segment with you I like to do sometimes called Get to Know Your Listener?
Oh, sure.
I've had wild success with this over the years. If you don't mind me asking, Ray, how old a fella are you?
I'm 26.
26-year-old Ray. Okay, you sound wise beyond your years, Ray, to be honest with you. So if you're 26, when the Colts were in the Super, or excuse me, when Indianapolis hosted the Super Bowl 10 years ago, you would have been theoretically a sophomore, junior in high school, somewhere in that range. Were you living in Indianapolis at that time?
Yeah, I actually snuck down there. I couldn't get in anywhere, but I snuck down and took a walk around and seen everything.
So, Ray, you're my spirit animal, living in places where you're not supposed to be. That's exactly, and I like that. I like that adventure. You were a student at what school during that time, Ray?
Lawrence Central.
Lawrence Central, okay.
The Bears.
You know, my sister teaches at Lawrence Central, Ray, just so you know. Okay, so now, Ray, if you don't mind me asking, your days compile now other than calling radio shows at 9, which we appreciate, but for the vast majority of time, you do what today? You're working where? You're doing what? Or your father? What's life like for Ray?
New time father. I have a 2-month-year-old, so getting adjusted to that and pretty much work from home and going to school at night, trying to get my real estate license and become somewhat what you would call an entrepreneur.
I like that. Now, Ray,
congrats on that, Ray.
Yeah, the little one. What's the little one's name?
August.
Okay, it's a beautiful name. All right. Well, Ray, we certainly wish the best to you and August, and also in your ventures. I know what it's like to be taking the classes at night, so we wish you the best in that. And when you call in from now on, I'll try to remember to ask you how August is doing. All right.
All right. Thank you so much, man.
That's Lawrence Central Bear Ray. We'll just call him Bear Ray from now on.
Boy, that's a lot. 2-month-old, night classes, good for Ray. But
Ray sounds like, now that sounds like the kind of guy that you listen to Ray, he's 26, and he just sounded like a nice guy, and you think to yourself, that guy's going to be an asset for some real estate company somewhere down the line, you can just tell. That guy's got it figured out.
My father-in-law is trending towards maybe retirement in the real estate world, so.
You know, Ray might graduate in August.
Ray could slide in.
Be a good month for him.
Well. Yeah. Do you graduate in August? Don't you usually kind of start in August?
Well, I think you make your own hours, right?
Yeah, well, I guess you are right about that. Doug Peterson, Jake, Ray brought it up. What do you think? If you're Trevor Lawrence, you sleeping a little better at night?
Yeah, I think that for Trevor, look, Jacksonville clearly, and this was a wise move because I think they knew they had to go out and get a coach that, look, I think the world of Trevor Lawrence's talent, I'm telling you. I know you're going to think I'm crazy or biased because I am a Clemson fan, but I'm telling you, if you go back and look at, and yes, he had unbelievable weapons. He's thrown to T. Higgins, and he's got Travis Etienne behind him, and, you know, he's got elite-level tight ends. I mean, all of it. Mike Williams. But when Trevor Lawrence arrived at Clemson, I mean, he unseats an upperclassman who had been to the college football playoff the year before, and Kelly Bryant. Dabo Sweeney hands the keys over to him, and he takes off. And he was so good at Clemson. I mean, his poise, his touch when he needs it to be there, his ability to run. He was, I'm telling you, the closest thing I've seen to a Peyton Manning in terms of his acumen to read and understand a defense and look over and make changes. I mean, elite. I remember Chris Fowler saying when he threw a touchdown pass against Alabama as a freshman in the national championship game that he dominated, mind you. I remember Chris Fowler saying, like, this guy looks like a 10-year NFL veteran, like laughing about it. The skill is there. Jacksonville did him no favors. He did not have a good year as a rookie. There's no doubt about it. He probably had a better rookie year than Peyton Manning had as a rookie, but he did not have a good rookie year. And so I think Jacksonville knows that they need to get a quarterback whisperer as their head coach. And that's what I think they've done.
I think they're going to figure it out. I think they got a lot of resources. I think they've got some important young talent at various spots. Obviously, the division's not super daunting to them moving forward, and I think they will figure it out. We'll see about any staff changes that impact the Colts. You know, the name, when you see Peterson get hired, you think of Jim Schwartz, who was defensive coordinator candidate here in Indianapolis. Jim Schwartz was the defensive coordinator under Doug Peterson in Philly. You know, Frank Reich overlap there with his coordinator days in 2016, 2017, but this could have, I don't think, a high number of staff changes that could impact the Colts. They don't have a ton of people from that Philly tree. Press Taylor is an offensive assistant, actually the younger brother, Zach Taylor. But Jim Schwartz, I think, would be the one name if the Colts are entertaining him as defensive coordinator. You know, would he find more appeal in getting back with
Doug Peterson? Does he feel like, you know, Peterson's tenure could be a little bit longer than Frank Reich's tenure here in Indianapolis? So I think that is something to keep an eye on. Speaking of the Super Bowl, Jake, we have the youngest combination ever of head coaches in the Super Bowl.
Really? And for that matter, and I don't know, who is Cincinnati's offensive coordinator?
I think it's like Brian Callahan, maybe. I think.
How old is he? Because it's got to be one of the younger, if you took the two head coaches and the two offensive coordinators.
Right, right.
I mean, you're still staying pretty young, right?
Yeah.
It is Brian Callahan. He's 37.
Yeah, so boom.
Right.
So both coordinators and both head coaches.
And Raheem Morris, I mean, the defensive coordinator for the Rams can't be that old. I don't know. He just looks so young. Sean McVay, 36. Zach Taylor, 38. 74 years of age. Have we ever had a Super Bowl coach at the age of 74?
Oldest NFL coach. How old was Bill Walsh at the end?
To coach in a Super Bowl.
Yeah,
74 is pretty old.
It is.
But I don't know. I mean, I feel like... how old's Pete Carroll? I always feel like Pete Carroll's a lot older than...
Raheem Morris is 45, by the way.
Pete Carroll is 70.
Doesn't that shock you?
He's so much older. I'm thinking 5 years younger than that.
Yeah.
At least.
This shows you the day and age. I saw a few days ago that Sean McVay and Zach Taylor are so young... They each had Rivals.com recruiting profiles.
Really?
In their football careers, and now here they are coaching the Super Bowl.
I'm looking up right now, oldest coach in Super Bowl history.
You're thinking Bill Walsh? How old is Marv Levy?
Probably not that old, Marv, right? Levy's got to be. That might be a good call there. That may be a good call on Marv Levy. Well, Belichick. Let's see. Don't you hate this?
Is Belichick 70 yet? I don't think he is.
Belichick is 68.
It's crazy.
Bruce Arians, the second oldest coach in Super Bowl history. How about that? Bruce Arians. So I got to see who that means is the oldest. Bruce Arians was 68 and 127 days. The oldest, by the way. George Halas is the oldest to win a championship. He did it at 68 and 331 days.
Okay.
So the oldest in a Super Bowl, the oldest to coach in a Super Bowl is Bruce Arians, apparently.
I figured somebody would have been 70. So with this Jacksonville.
Marv Levy is oldest, Bruce Arians second oldest. But anyway.
With Jacksonville being filled up now, Texans, Saints, Dolphins, is that right?
Vikings, right?
Well, Vikings got the Rams off.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Nothing official yet, but that's supposedly.
You said Dolphins, Saints,
and Texans. And I want to say the Texans or the Saints announced Brian Flores as a finalist.
I mean, he should.
I would hire Brian Flores. I know that some people are like, well, you don't want to deal with the legal matter and CNN showing up.
If Brian Flores said that his dream in life is to live in Indianapolis, Indiana, would you tell Frank Reich, hey, I appreciate it?
Yeah, I'd say you want to call plays and then have Brian Flores be the head coach.
Right. I mean, I'm with you, man.
Yeah, that's the route. And again, I was saying this back when Flores just got fired. I don't think that. And by the way, I feel like the more, based off what the Giants, their statement yesterday, Jake, boy, I really feel like this is going to be difficult for Brian Flores to prove in the court of law the racism aspect.
He's taken a big step. There's no doubt. I mean, the text.
And I know nothing legally, but it just seems like a daunting climb.
Again, for those that are unfamiliar, here is the specific of what happened. Brian Flores had an interview with the New York Giants. An interview, by the way, with a general manager who was just hired from DePaul University. Not from, but a graduate of DePaul. A young guy as well.
Joe Shane.
Bill Belichick, who Brian Flores had coached under, texted Brian Flores and congratulated him on getting the New York Giant head coaching job. There is another Brian. Which Brian is that, Kevin?
Dable.
Brian Dable.
Another former Belichick assistant.
Correct. Brian Dable actually was the one who had been given the job. So Brian Flores writes back to Bill Belichick and says, well, thanks for congratulating me. But, Coach, I haven't interviewed yet. My interview is like on Friday. And Belichick says, well, I was told that you're the guy and you are who they're hiring. Brian Flores then realizes, wait a minute, Brian Daboll, I think, interviewed like 2 days ago. So he writes Belichick back in the text and says, you know you're texting with Brian Flores, right? And Belichick responds and says, oh my gosh, I am so sorry. Like, I have completely screwed this up. It is Brian Daboll that they've hired. So Brian Flores then puts two and two together and says, wait a minute. If they have already interviewed Brian Daboll and seemingly offered him the job or come to the conclusion that he is the guy, enough to the point where another NFL coach is seemingly thinking he's congratulating Brian Daboll, then why are they bringing me in on Friday for an interview? They have no interest in hiring me. They are only interviewing me to meet a criteria of the Rooney Rule of a minority interview, which is totally patronizing and condescending to Brian Flores, who is a really good, by all account, football coach, and from everything I've heard, I don't know him, a really good guy and a well-respected man. So that's where that comes from. Now,
doesn't he need evidence of literally the Mara family being like, hey, we got to check the Rooney Rule box?
I would certainly hope that we're not resting everything on phone calls and footlockers, right? I mean, you are correct. That is going to be, he has put himself in position, unfortunately, of a Colin Kaepernick type situation, right? Of you've got to prove, it's one thing by all account to look like you have been, you know, kept out, but you've got to prove it now.
And those sham interviews do happen.
Of course.
I talked about it earlier in the week. I thought that the Colts had a guy under Ryan Grigson by the name of Jimmy Ray, who had a nice resume, but I'm like, man, Jimmy Ray's name is getting brought up again for these jobs. And someone in the building was like, well, you know, unfortunately, it's probably for this Rooney Rule. And I'm thinking to myself, gosh, is that really happening around the league? And that aspect to it, unfortunately, I think it's going to be very difficult for Flores to prove. The tampering and the $100,000 of Stephen Ross, that could be a whole nother can of worms that obviously some evidence is going to be needed to unpack there as well, and could be severely damaging to Stephen Ross's ownership and the Dolphins franchise. So stuff that we'll certainly talk about more next week as well. All right, before we get to the pop quiz, Jake, Big O Tire Sports Center update.
The Sports Center update on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan is presented by Big O Tires, the team you trust.
We can do it fairly quickly since we have the pop quiz coming up. But last night in the NBA, Toronto, a 127-120 winner in overtime over the Chicago Bulls. Jake, what relevance is that to me? I'm listening to a radio station in Indianapolis. Good question. Thanks for asking. Because the Pacers will be hosting those same Bulls tonight at Gainbridge Fieldhouse. There is some question as to who may or may not be available for the Bulls, right, Kevin?
Yeah, back-to-back, you know, north of the border, there's questions usually about, you know, that team and their availability the next night. But Zach LaVine played 42 minutes, played through a back injury, so he is in question. The Bulls are in the midst of a 4-game-in-5-night stretch. DeMar DeRozan played 45 minutes, so we'll have to check the injury report a little bit later on exactly which Bulls team the Pacers and you will be seeing inside of Gainbridge Fieldhouse tonight. A couple other Pacers notes. No All-Star for Domantas Sabonis. I don't think that's too shocking. Individually, has put up some tremendous numbers, but when you're 13th in the Eastern Conference, it is going to be a steep climb to be an All-Star reserve. Those are voted on by the coaches, by the way. On another note, Lance Stephenson has signed a contract for the rest of this season. No further contract than that, so he'll be a free agent. But no more 10 days for Lance Stephenson. He is going to be, that act will be playing inside of Gainbridge Fieldhouse for the rest of the year.
By the way, one other note in the NBA last night. Clippers over the Lakers won 111-110. Only significant because Reggie Jackson had a game-winning layup with 4 seconds left, which is impressive considering he once hit 3 home runs off 3 different pitchers in the World Series. College basketball tomorrow, Illinois and Indiana at noon. That game is going to be at the Simon Scott Assembly Hall. Also at noon tomorrow, it is St. John's and Butler at Hinkle Fieldhouse. The other game at noon, Robert Morris and IUPUI. Michigan and Purdue is a 2:30 start tomorrow.
Fun matchup tomorrow will be Trace Jackson Davis against Kofi Coburn. Here was the Center Grove product on facing Kofi.
Kofi's a great player. Obviously, last night he had a great game. I was surprised Wisconsin didn't double him. That was a little weird to me. But there's certain things that he likes to do that we're going to take away from him. We're going to throw different bigs at him. Hopefully I can use my quickness and my athleticism to try and slow him down. So that'll be a big game. But it's going to be a big game, not only for me, but for my teammates as well, because Illinois in general, they're shooting the ball really well from the three as well. So especially with Plummer and Frazier. So we got a lot of, they got a lot of key pieces that we got to slow down, but he's probably the biggest factor.
And you think back to that Purdue game, Jake, the Indiana got away with Trace Jackson Davis getting into early foul trouble. I thought it was a mistake for him to guard Zach Edey one-on-one really early in that game. It doesn't sound like they're going to make that same mistake based off what Trace just said there. More doubles. I'd even put Race Thompson on him just to save him, not only offensively, but save him from foul trouble as well. But it's going to be a fun one. After Indiana's had a week off, you know, it'd be another quality win on the resume for them and further strengthen them right now firmly on the right side of the ball.
You know, Brad Underwood, I like a lot at Illinois. I like him as a guy. Met him a couple times. Like
seems like
passion.
A great dude. Almost beat Notre Dame in the tournament with Stephen F. Austin.
Just a darn good coach, right? I mean, yeah. I think they are. You, one thing about Illinois, you know, is, you know, Joe Wiz said Indiana's going to win the game, but Illinois is going to be well coached.
We had a question earlier about Isaiah Jackson, his availability. This is from James Boyd. He is out for tonight. So they
that
might.
Sucks.
Are you 6'4"?
I am.
So you and Terry Taylor in the post tonight?
That's right. He'd be on my shoulders, yeah.
Yeah. He might have a chance against
it'd be like the
Nikola Vucevic.
Terry Taylor can get on my shoulders.
Is that a halftime show act?
Well, it looks a lot actually like the game of chicken that took place last night at the Hilton Garden Inn in the saltwater pool with Tony Katz actually got Jimmy Cook got on his shoulders and
Jimmy Cook.
My understanding is they narrowly knocked off Brendan King and Kurt Darling.
Oh, wow. Boy. Yes. John Herrick officiating, is that what you said?
That's exactly right. That's gotcha. Exactly right.
Man, yep. Darn, I missed that. Hopefully there's some video of that.
Stan Lear was officiating. John Herrick doing play-by-play.
Stan Lear's got a great voice. Just a quick college basketball rundown. Jake's mentioned some of this. Purdue, Michigan, that is 2:30 on Fox tomorrow. Purdue will face Michigan twice in 5 days. Purdue, they didn't get back to West Lafayette. It sounds like they could be getting back like right now, or they had to spend the night in Minneapolis, and then stay in Indy last night. They weren't able to fly into that Purdue
airport.
That
Eric
there.
Berman's a ringer at the chicken, don't you think?
Indiana, Illinois. He knows his stuff, by the way. Great follow on Twitter. That is a noon tip from Bloomington's Assembly Hall and Butler St. John's at noon.
Eric Berman was on Jeopardy once. Did you know that?
Really?
I'm fairly certain that's correct.
I did not know that. St. John's, remember when Indiana played them and we're like, wow, that could look like a quality win. 11-9 and 3-6 in the Big East.
That's a program, man. I'm telling you, there are three programs, Kevin, that during my childhood that I look at now and I'm like, what? St. John's is one of them. St. John's was massive. DePaul, one of them. And even though they've had a resurgence, Houston. Memphis, another one that was really good.
I thought you were going to say Georgetown.
Georgetown, that's a good one. I still think of Georgetown as relevant, even though I realize they're kind of not.
It's pop quiz time. It's Freebie Friday, so we'll be giving away a free Jiffy Lube prize pack. Give us a ring, 317-239-1070 right here for a, I would guess, a heavily hinted pop quiz from Jake Query and myself, Kevin Bowen. 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
At HeroLoan.com, we always keep it 100. Get the loan that you've earned and keep it 100 at HeroLoan.com, the only way to VA.
NMLS number 1326241.
Join us on The Fan every Thursday from 7 to 8 p.m. to tune in with Jason Hammer on You Bet with Bet Rivers. This week, we're talking NFL playoffs.
Want the same internet but more privacy? DuckDuckGo's got you covered. With one download, you can search and browse privately, avoiding trackers all for free. DuckDuckGo. Privacy simplified.
We buy any car. We buy any car. We buy any car. Any.
Did you know trading in your car at a dealer could cost you money? A recent study found consumers who trade in their car pay an average of $990 more. So don't trade in. Sell it to We Buy Any Car. Learn more and get your free online valuation now at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Find out how much your car's worth at WeBuyAnyCar.com.
Life's full of unexpected joys, like problems with water. That's why there's Michelis, a crew of 24/7 experts who are rescue ready, day or night, one phone call, for a gazillion disasters. Over 3 decades of restoring your home or business to better than new condition. Water, storms, fire, and foundations. Life happens. Michelis happens to help you through it. Call 844-FIX-INDY. Make it Michelis.
With PatriotSoftware.com, accounting and payroll, keep your time in mind.
Mike Cappell here, serial entrepreneur.
Doing payroll is no longer a headache for our customer, Jeff.
I've used various payroll providers in the past, and none can hold a candle to Patriot Software. Their software is ridiculously easy to use. The support staff is knowledgeable and courteous. I am very excited that Patriot Software files my tax forms for me, not just providing the forms like other payroll companies do. As a business owner, managing payroll has been a long-time headache that I no longer struggle with thanks to Patriot Software. I definitely rate your company 5 out of 5 stars.
Go to PatriotSoftware.com to get your payroll pricing for up to 100 employees. Use promo code RADIO and get 2 months of payroll processing free. That's PatriotSoftware.com.
PatriotSoftware.com. Accounting and payroll. Keep your time and money.
Big O Tires, you know, the folks who are locally owned and operated with the lowest price on every tire every day? Well, they have big savings on Michelin tires all February long. Big O Tires has convenient online appointment scheduling available at BigOTires.com. So log on now to see Shane in Mooresville, Josh in Plainfield, Alan in Lebanon, Steve and Victor in Whitestown, Derek at 86 in Zionsville Road, and Mike in Brownsburg. Big O also does brakes, alignments, oil changes, fluids, batteries, and more, and they offer no credit needed financing. That's Big O Tires, the team you trust.
Talking to my friend Larry Howald. He owns Howald Heating, Air Conditioning, and Plumbing. He told me he loves cold weather. He gave me a few great furnace tips. First one, easy. Keep your furnace filter clean. Dirty filter makes furnace problems. Furnace on the fritz? Check the door. Make sure it's closed all the way. Safety switch engaged, and make sure the thermostat is on, batteries are charged. Finally, shameless plug for Larry. If you find yourself left out in the cold, call 317-953-4698 or 317-953-HOW.
When the Colts were looking for a quarterback,
Wentz checked the safest boxes while also offering hope that there was more there.
Look, the bigger question is this.
If you're talking about it.
Right now, your best option is Carson Wentz next year.
So you know what that tells me?
As far as the defensive coordinator position is concerned, Chris Richard, Jim Swartz, Gus Bradley.
We're talking about it.
I'd do it in a second.
Your home for Indy sports. 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Have you studied? Can you handle the pressure? Sharpen your pencils. It's time for the Pop Quiz with Kevin and Querry. Brought to you by Jiffy Lube, Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
By the way, before we begin the Pop Quiz, I would like to extend a sincere congratulations to Vince, who is celebrating a 2-year landmark today. Vince, congratulations on that, and continue moving forward in the right direction. But very happy to hear that for Vince and his 2-year
awesome.
Mark.
Awesome.
It is time for the Pop Quiz, and you said it's Freebie Friday, right?
Freebie Friday. So Jiffy Lube prize pack going to our participant, not even winner, today. You got a number for us?
I will go with number... Well, we just said Vince is having a 2-year anniversary. We'll go with the number 2.
Eddie. Josh, who we got?
Eddie.
Eddie!
Hello, good morning.
Eddie, how you doing?
I'm good, you're good.
You battle the elements yet, Eddie?
Yes, I was the only one that came into work for shift yesterday, and I'm probably the only one here today.
Too. Now, Eddie, if you don't mind me asking, when you say you're the only one going into work, what line of work are you in?
Loss prevention and security.
Oh, really? So you bust shoplifters?
That's right, yeah.
What's the highest number of items you've seen somebody Bogarting in their pants?
$500-$600. I mean, small items are worth $300-$400 a piece sometimes. Yeah.
Really? Now, yeah. Most people, when you stop them, are they shifty? How can you tell when somebody's? Is it a mannerism deal, or do you catch them in the act? How does that work?
Yeah, you definitely have to catch them stealing it. You know, you can't be guessing on anything like that. When you stop someone, that would not be good. So, yeah, you got to be sure.
Eddie, what part of town are you working on? How's the commute?
Decent. I'd say 60%, 70% of the road. I could see a little bit of blacktop, but basically up by the Castleton area.
Okay.
Awesome.
Well, Eddie, we appreciate you listening to the show.
I'm
going to
give Eddie a lot
in.
Of hints because he could come find me, Jake.
That's right? True. Eddie, have you noticed that the self-checkout gives you job security?
Yeah, that would be the case, yeah.
Okay, well, good. All right, here we go. Question number 1. The Winter Olympics got underway yesterday in Beijing. Who hosted the 2018 Winter Olympics? Hard to believe that was 4 years ago. Was it A, Sochi, Russia? B, Pyeongchang, South Korea? C, Vancouver, Canada? Or D, Milan, Italy?
B.
B, okay.
Nice. Yeah, I wouldn't try and pronounce it either. IUPUI fell to Youngstown State last night. The Jags are now 2-18 with their wins coming over Spalding, a ball, and right. East-West University of the USCAA. Who was the last NCAA Division I school defeated by IUPUI in men's basketball? A, Youngstown State.
Me. They're the Penguins.
B, Illinois Chicago. C, Green Bay. D, Milwaukee.
Good day.
That's a good start, Eddie. Very good.
I'm sitting here racking my brain. I don't recall the Olympics being at P.F. Chang's. Do you remember that?
Well, no, South Korea, Jake, is where it was. Do they have a P.F. Chang's in South Korea? Have you been?
Let me tell you, it might not be the chicken. What's that?
Have you been?
To P.F. Chang's or to South Korea?
To South Korea.
I have not. Have you?
No, can't say I have.
I have a bottle of North Korean beer in my refrigerator, by the way, that somebody brought back from North Korea. How about that? Nothing like the taste of communism in a bottle. The Jacksonville Jaguars have hired Doug Peterson as their head coach, Eddie. The Jags were an NFL worst 3-14 last season. They are the fourth team to hire a Super Bowl winning coach coming off posting the worst record in the league. The 93 Patriots and 97 Jets both hired Bill Parcells. Name the other team to try to get out of the cellar by hiring a coach who had won a Super Bowl. Was it A, the Detroit Lions, B, the Washington Commanders, which were known as a different name then, C, the New Orleans Saints, or D, the Kansas City Chiefs?
I'll go with B.
Okay.
All right, number four, the Brooklyn Nets interplay tonight, riding a six-game losing streak. Name the last NBA team to win a championship despite having a six-game skid during the season. They also hosted a very cold Super Bowl. A, the Dallas Mavericks. B, the Seattle Supersonics. C, the Rochester Royals. Or D, the Detroit Pistons?
The Pistons.
Boy, I guess you go there too, but remember that ice storm down there, Jake?
Which one?
For that city? For the Super Bowl?
Oh, yeah, it was brutal, right?
Right.
People didn't get their seats, all kinds of disaster. Hey,
our benefit.
All right, here we go. Last question for you, Eddie. You ready?
Yes.
Today marks the 15th anniversary of the Colts beating the Chicago Bears in Super Bowl 41. Who scored the Colts' final touchdown in the game, which everybody in Indianapolis was thrilled about, except for you, because it actually came from a takeaway, so you felt very conflicted and cheering about it? A defensive back out of Illinois. His first name actually is a metric of electricity, I think, like a measure of electricity. What's that?
I said Bob Sanders, but that doesn't make sense with your recent clue.
It's kind of close to my name.
It is close to your name.
Calvin Hayden.
That guy. What he just said.
Calvin Hayden will lock him in as the guess.
Eddie's got more important things to worry about today. Luckily, it is Freebie Friday here. Good start for Eddie. Number one, where was the 2018 Winter Olympics? Pyeongchang. Am I saying that right, Jake?
Pyeongchang. Yeah, sure. P.F. Chang's, yep.
Youngstown State. They were indeed the last team to lose to IUPUI. That's wild, by the way. February 2020, Jake, the last time IUPUI beat a D1 team.
And the most convoluted and long-winded question in the history of the pop quiz since the time that I've been doing this, the answer to the last team coming off of the worst record to hire a coach who had previously won a Super Bowl was the New Orleans Saints in 1976.
You blew it!
You don't get to come back tomorrow. You don't even get a lousy copy of our home game. You're a complete loser.
You're right about Dallas. Remember, the reason I got thrown off when you said that, Kevin, I went to the Super Bowl. I was at Super Bowl 34 in Atlanta.
Yeah, when I said it out loud, I was like, gosh, you could go Atlanta if that was one of the choices. But also, I'm sure Detroit, didn't Detroit have a Super Bowl?
They did.
And I'm guessing it was cold. So
I'm telling you, the
once I said it out loud, I was
the
like,
the Atlanta
stupid.
Super Bowl, there was an ice storm, and it was a total disaster. I mean, it was when the Georgia Dome first opened. It was a mess. Atlanta, you couldn't get anywhere. It was terrible. Kelvin Hayden, by the way, had the 56-yard interception return that sealed it for the Colts in the Super Bowl 15 years ago today.
When we come back here on Kevin Aquaria one final time, a little bit of update on the Colts defensive coordinator search. We'll touch on that. And how much is a Super Bowl commercial for this year?
Ooh, that's a good question.
Week from Sunday. We'll hit on that as well. Kevin Aquaria one final time here, 93.5 107.5, The Fan.
Switch to Spectrum Mobile and get unlimited data for only $29.99 per month each when you get two or more lines. You could save hundreds on your mobile bill. Plus, there are no added taxes, hidden fees, and no contracts. Try the Spectrum Mobile Savings Calculator today, and in three easy steps, you'll see how much you could save. Visit SpectrumMobile.com/save. Offer valid for new customers on two or more unlimited lines. Spectrum Internet required. Restrictions apply. Visit SpectrumMobile.com for details.
Love. It makes us do crazy things, like being the first one to say, I love you. Or adopting a cat together when you're more of a dog person. Celebrate the madness of love with a perfect Valentine's gift from Helzberg Diamonds. Right now, half-carat diamond heart pendants in your choice of white, yellow, or rose gold are just $399.99, a savings of $400. Show her you're smitten with the gift of gorgeous jewelry at our best prices of the season. Hurry, Valentine's Day is Monday, February 14th. Shop at Helzberg.com or visit a store near you.
Did you know Amazon provides ways of working that fit your lifestyle? They know you value your time outside of work, juggling family, school, friends, or other activities. That's why they offer a variety of shifts that work for you. There are full-time, part-time, and even temporary opportunities that can work with your schedule, with great starting pay and sign-on bonuses. If you want a career that fits and adapts to your lifestyle, head to Amazon.com/apply. Amazon is a proud equal opportunity employer.
Sign up for BetMGM and find out why they are the king of parlays. Use one game parlay to make multiple selections within a single game from hundreds of betting options. How about supercharging your payout for even more winnings? Well, try Parlay Boost. Or maybe you're fearless and want to take a shot at Parlay Generator. Sign up on the BetMGM app or website using the bonus code The Fan, all one word, capital T, capital F, and your first bet will be risk-free up to $1,000. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. 21 years of age or older to wager. Indiana only. New customer offer. All promotions are subject to qualification and eligibility requirements. Rewards issued as non-withdrawable free bets or site credit. Free bets expire 7 days from issuance. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem and wants help, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Of course, she needs a college education, but I don't want her buried in student loans for the rest of her life.
It starts here.
She needs a school with great resources, but some of these campuses are so big.
The School of Health and Human Sciences at IUPUI has the resources of a big university on a campus with a hometown feel. It's a more affordable option with access to career paths in Indy's world-class healthcare and sports entertainment hospitality organizations.
At those big schools, I'm worried she'll just be a number.
Hey, it starts here.
Hey, why not IUPUI?
That's what I was thinking.
The need for healthcare workers is growing, and a health sciences degree prepares students for growing careers as physician's assistant or for pre-med and pre-PT and OT programs. Partnerships at Indy hospitals and research facilities provide hands-on learning opportunities.
The School of Health and Human Sciences at IUPUI. It starts here. Learn more at shhs.iupui.edu.
Hey, it's John for Love Heating and Air. John and Chris Love with the best service this time of year, making sure you're warm and toasty in your home, and that no-cost second opinion at 317-353-2141. And if you mention my name, you'll get $125 off the most advanced air purification system that's out there. That's iWave. Right now, use my name, Love Heating and Air Conditioning, 317-353-2141, online, love-hvac.com.
Here's what's happening with the Fan.
JMV gives away Night Ranger tickets all week, 3 to 6 p.m. Listen to call in for your chance to see the band perform next week at the Paramount in Anderson. Think you have the best sports trivia knowledge? Listen to Kevin and Query from 7 to 10 a.m. and call into the pop quiz for your chance at a Jiffy Lube prize pack. And follow the Fan on social media. The Fan is on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Like and follow the Fan for updates, giveaways, and all things sports.
For more info, click on 1075thefan.com. The Pacers host their rivals from the north, the Chicago Bulls, this evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
13 minutes before the top of the hour. My name is Jake Query. Kevin Bowen is the other voice you hear in this program. Josh Mullinex capably filling in on the big board. Mark Dykton is back with us. I believe, is Mark back on Monday or is he?
No, we got Josh again. Josh be doing laps in the saltwater pool all weekend long.
You staying in the hotel all weekend, Josh?
I am not.
Party at your place?
Despite the invitation from Tony Katz in the salt pool.
That's right. By the way, Richard points out, thank you, Richard, for pointing this out. This is why you never trust a guy that flunked every math and science class he's ever taken when he's on a microphone. A Kelvin is a unit of temperature. I was thinking a Kelvin was a unit of energy, like a watt.
Also a very good basketball coach who cheats.
That is correct, yeah. I don't know what I was thinking.
Jim wanted me to clarify as well on the Rooney Rule and Brian Flores. If I'm not mistaken, Jake, and I need to double check this, I think the Giants also interviewed Leslie Frazier. And their GM, Joe Shane, came from the Bills. So the Leslie Frazier connection, the Brian Daboll connection obviously makes sense from a Buffalo standpoint. I think you have to have two external candidates, if I'm not mistaken. Two external minority candidates to satisfy the Rooney Rule. In-house, Patrick Graham, their defensive coordinator, he interviewed at several stops around the league. He is black, but I don't think he would necessarily qualify. So that's another layer to this Flores thing that obviously we'll have to see play out. Okay, in 1967, Jake, the cost of a 30-second Super Bowl ad was what?
In 1967, a 30-second Super Bowl ad would have cost $21,000.
This number astonishes me. $360,000.
Really? That's way higher than I would have guessed. Really? Although I will say, back then, Kevin, you only had four networks, right? In 1967. So that was really naive on my guess. Now it makes sense because...
I mean, I would have guessed something right around what you guessed.
But the share that you would have gotten would have been so massive, right?
But, I mean, isn't the share still massive today?
It is.
Today, how much you think? 30-second Super Bowl ad here in 2022.
I think these have come down a little bit.
Inflation adjusted, by the way. I probably should have mentioned that.
Okay. Okay.
Sorry. That.
So that 367 was inflated. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally read that wrong.
So today, and I always forget if we're talking 30s or 60s, and I'm certainly no.
30. Cost of a 30-second Super Bowl ad.
I know, but I'm saying, like, I you know, when they say Super Bowl ads are, I think it got up to like $1.5 million for a 60. A 60-second. I'm going to say for a 30-second ad, it's $610,000.
This says $6 million.
Come on. I thought it was $1.5
million
for a 60. I thought it was
a couple million for a 30.
Maybe I'm way off base here. You would think I know. I worked in TV forever, but.
The company with the most Super Bowl ads.
Anheuser-Busch.
Bud Light's at 26. Doritos 19, Budweiser 18.
What was the first one?
Bud Light 26.
Okay.
Doritos 19, Budweiser 18.
So Anheuser-Busch is number one.
Right.
Because
easily.
Now, here's the thing about Super Bowl commercials, Kevin.
GoDaddy's had 12.
And here's the problem with like GoDaddy. This was the problem. Do you remember the one year it was the Super Bowl, like 2000 or 2001, every commercial was for a .com, like a new .com.
Yeah,
right. And I mean, half of them went under within like a year. The problem with Super Bowl commercials, and I wish that ad executives would figure this out. everybody is trying to do the most creative or the most funny or the most heartfelt tear jerk commercial. That's not the power of a commercial. The power of the commercial, like there was one, for example, I'm going back 15 years ago. There was a Super Bowl commercial that everybody loved that was set in Italy, and it was for, it showed a guy taking a pill, and you would assume that it was supposed to be a Viagra, and he drops it, and then it falls out the window, and it goes down the alley, like in the little villa they're in Italy, and then eventually it landed inside of a little car that then like got bigger. And the ad was for like Fiat, like the Fiat 300 was now the Fiat 500 or whatever. And everyone, the next day when they scored the commercials, everyone's reaction was, I love the commercial for the erectile dysfunction pill. Well, you've completely, you've wasted your time. Because people come up with what they think is a creative or a funny thing, but if people don't remember what the right product is for, it's a total waste of time.
I was going to say, simple message can go a long way.
Correct. I thought the greatest, I'll tell you, the greatest Super Bowl commercial that I've ever seen in terms of effectiveness, and people are like, that was lame. But FedEx, like 15 years ago, bought a 30-second spot, and the screen was color bars. And tone. And so you're, whatever you're doing, you stop because you're like, whoa, what just happened? Like the CBS just lost the feed. And you stop and look at it, and then it scrolls across the bottom and says, we apologize, but the person who was supposed to deliver the advertisement in this spot did not use FedEx and with the FedEx logo. Had they used FedEx with the FedEx logo, you would be seeing a commercial right now that you would have loved.
That makes sense.
And it's perfect, right?
Mm-hmm, for sure.
Because everyone stopped, everyone saw it. Now, people weren't like, you know, it's not funny. It wasn't like some little kid with a tearjerk moment. But you remember what the commercial's for. 15 years later, I still remember it.
Right. I always think Doritos, and I am biased, heavily biased. I love Doritos. But I also think they do a great job.
They do.
Early product placement.
Like, they do.
There's Doritos back within the first, you know, 5 seconds.
Okay, how about this? Which do you think, if you were an advertiser, would you rather buy an ad? Would you rather, let's say, spend $7 million for a 30-second ad that is guaranteed to go right after kickoff, or spend $4 million on a 30-second ad that is guaranteed to go right after the final horn?
Well, I think a lot depends on what product you have. I think if you're trying to cater to a wide range of demographics, halftime.
Okay. But my point being that you have a risk at the end of the game.
Right, right. Losing.
If it comes down to the final play of the game.
I think a lot of it depends on risk-reward as a company. Right. Yeah, all of those things. No, I think that's a great debate.
We should do a Kevin and Query ad during the Super Bowl. Wouldn't that go over well?
They could put us on, they could put the game in Wingdings, Jake, and I don't think we'd be, on the telecast that,
people would be like, who are those two guys?
Yeah, exactly there. I got a DM from someone that says, please don't give out my handle, Jake, or Kevin, but a source says that Gus Bradley is going to be the Colts' new defensive coordinator. Take care.
Now, he's the guy from 60 Minutes, right?
What was it, Bradley that played basketball at Princeton? Was it Bill?
Bill Bradley.
Bill Bradley.
He was the Final Four most outstanding player.
Should we believe the Twitter DM?
Bill Bradley, by the way, had the record for most points in a Final Four forever. Sometimes those DMs, Kevin, I'm telling you, well, don't say the name, but is the person trustworthy?
Well, I have no idea. It's just like a fan.
Okay.
They have 13 followers.
We will give you full credit if it happens.
Yes, we will. We'll certainly come back with that. Gus Bradley, former Jacksonville coach.
Wasn't it a direct message to Tony Donahue that said Brad Stevens is leaving to go to the Celtics?
I mean, I have had numerous direct messages in my time that have failed miserably in terms of sources, and then some that I'm like,
sliding into your DMs. Well, Kevin.
No, not like that. But yeah, Gus Bradley, the former Jacksonville head coach, comes from the Seattle tree, most recently with the Raiders and Chargers as their respective defensive coordinators. So we'll see how the defensive coordinator situation plays out for the Colts. Again, everybody, commute wasn't too bad. Roads are clearing a little bit. Stay safe out there. Enjoy sledding the day at home, whatever you're doing. Jake, any weekend plans?
Not really. Pace your game tonight.
Another game tonight.
That's it. Chilling.
All right, we'll be back on Monday, 7 a.m. Josh Molinex. Thank you. Talk to you then.
School is in session.
Coach Tom Izzo, you called timeout 12 seconds ago.
17 to 22-year-olds today aren't as focused in on the task at hand. No, Nike has not come out with a belt buckle that has a phone that I can text them to. I have complete faith that my guys aren't always on the exact same page, so the timeout can get them on the exact same page.
Dan Dockage, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.